Good morning and welcome to the 20th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Please note that apologies have been received from Stephanie Callaghan, and I welcome Colin Beattie, who is attending as a substitute, and Mark Griffin will be joining us remotely. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the Housing Scotland Bill from two panels of witnesses. And we're joined on our first panel today in the room by John Blackwood, who's the Chief Executive at the Scottish Association of Landlords, Dr. John Boyle, who is the Director of Research and Strategy at RETIS, Timothy Douglas, who's the Head of Policy and Campaigns at PropertyMark, and Anna Gardner, who's the Policy Advisor of Rural Property at Scottish Land and Estates. And we're joined online by Robin Blacklock, who's the Managing Director at Dowbray Limited, and Cedric Boucher, who is the Chief Executive at Hearthstone Investments. And I welcome witnesses to the meeting. We're going to turn to questions, and we'll try to direct our questions to specific witnesses where possible. But if you would like to come in, please indicate really clearly to myself or the clerks. And for those online, please do this by typing an R in the chat function, although I believe one of you needs to put your hand up in Zoom, and that's fine as well. There's no need for you to turn on your microphones on and off. We'll be doing that for you. Overall, the Scottish Government states that the bill contains a package of reforms that will help ensure people have a safe, secure and affordable place to live. And I think what we want to understand from this discussion today is your perspective on that. So we're going to start with an area. I've got a number of questions around rent. And what I'd like to hear is, and I think this one is actually for everybody in general, but particularly if you've got something new to add, what your views are on the provision of the rent control areas in the bill and whether you think that will lead to a much sought after rent stabilisation if that was to be brought in particular areas in Scotland. And maybe I'll just start, John Blackwood, with yourself.
Okay, thank you. First of all, thank you for inviting us to give evidence as well too. I think our biggest concern going forward is about the supply of rented accommodation in Scotland. And what we're hearing from our members is that they're actively selling up and leaving the sector. And that's having an impact on, of course, supply and the resultant rents that are being charged at the moment. So we're really concerned that if we don't have investor confidence in the sector, investor landlords will leave of all sizes and shapes and forms. And that will make it harder for renters to find a home in the future. So our concern is largely about supply, but of course the resultant cost of that. And we see the costs of renting, regardless of rent control, will continue to increase. Now, of course, rent control could give a degree of stabilisation. Of course, it can do that. But nevertheless, the direction of travel is always with rent control that rents will increase in the future. And our concern is how sustainable is that for the overall sector? And many of our members are saying, actually, the whole sector needs to be affordable for landlords too. So many of our members are saying we can no longer afford to continue to let this property simply because of rising costs, which of course they're unable to pass on to their tenant customers. So there's a big issue there from an affordability perspective from landlords who are actively now, you know, 1 in 10 of our members surveyed who responded said that basically their rental properties are no longer financially viable for them. So that's a major concern for investor confidence going forward.
Okay, thanks very much for that. You've kind of gone on to my next question, but I just want to be clear that rent control areas are not going to be blanketed across Scotland. There's a process whereby local authorities will review the situation, and then I think the idea in the bill is that ministers will then look at whether to bring those forward, whether they're appropriate. But so back to my initial question, what are your views on the rent control areas and the provision in the bill? Timothy, you indicated you wanted to come in.
Yes, and again, thank you very much on behalf of PropertyMark for inviting us to give evidence today. I think before we come to the provisions, just to build on what John was saying, I think a lot of the policy work leading up to the legislation was talking about affordable rent, supply of rented homes and raising standards. But unfortunately, I think the bill does very little to increase the supply of private rented homes. And I think there's a frustration from the sector that the only proposal on the table to deal with affordability is rent control. The sector is very clear. What we hear from letting agent members is rent levels are high because there are too many people who have to rent and not enough homes available. I think on the proposals in the bill itself, I'm happy to go into more detail, but I think that the proposals for rent control areas are inconsistent and need to be simplified if they're going to be applied across the country. So essentially the bill's doing nothing from the outset to meet the huge demand crisis that we're seeing in the private rented sector. And therefore, there's a huge disconnect, I think, between what the Scottish Government and the ministers are proposing and what ourselves and John has been alluding to, what's happening in the market. So even before we get to the provisions, I think we would like to see, from property market perspective, the Scottish Government commit in the legislation to review all the costs and taxes that have been implemented on private landlords in recent years, and that should be done within 6 months of the bill passing, because as John's alluded to, we just don't feel the Minister and Scottish Government have got a grapple on the investment side of the sector. We've had a 6% ADS on LVTT. There's been changes, yes, introduced by the UK government in terms of changes by mortgage interest release on landlords, the wear and tear allowance, capital gains tax has now reduced. But we can't just shrug our shoulders in Scotland and say, well, they're introduced by the UK government, they're nothing to do with us. Well, there are their impacts in landlords in Scotland. So we need to have a clearer picture about what the costs and the taxes are affecting landlords in Scotland. And also, I think in the legislation, we need to commit to publish an annual parliamentary update on the state of the sector. I just don't feel we're getting that understanding. There's a real disconnect. Disconnect is the key word we're hearing. So that's our initial thoughts on the bill. As I've said, so the proposals for rent control areas we think are inconsistent. You know, the data collection element provides a backstop date, end of November, for that 2026, for that to happen. But why aren't we saying that? So that means the 5-year trigger for all local authorities to collect that data, they'll all be working to different dates unless we say it must happen by that date. So that means the trigger for further reviews will all be inconsistent across the 32 local authorities. In terms of the designated area, well, local authorities at Part 1, Section 2 can designate any area. So that could be a street, a cluster of houses, a ward or a borough. So again, that's going to be inconsistent. We could have neighbouring councils, local authorities, all doing different things. And I think that plays back into the point around on the amounts that can be designated in a rent control area, Section 9. Well, they're giving the local authorities the option to have a specific percentage or a range or percentage or something else. Again, that is not consistent across the board when certainly our members are managing multiple tenancies at all one go. And I think the final point I'll make is,
final
just
point,
on inconsistency,
please,
is there is no statutory timetable, no statutory time for the minister to report back once they've received a report. So how is the sector going to have that consistency and then be able to relay that back from an agent point of view to tenants and landlords going forward? Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Timothy. Just before I bring in John, you've indicated to speak, I just want to say, Anna, we've got some special rural focused questions for you in particular coming up. So we might move in. So don't feel you need to address the issue here, because I know that part of what you're coming for is around the rural perspective, and that's coming up right after this. So just want to say that I'm hearing from both John and Timothy already that, you know, there's an issue around supply. It'd be interesting to understand, you know, the information about that, and I think we'll get on to data and that kind of thing a bit later about how we can track that. But also, I think it's also really helpful to understand that this bill sits in a piece of work which is called the Housing to Strategy 2040. So there are other things that are happening that will address supply and a commitment to bring that forward. So this bill is, you know, has a particular focus around what I said at the beginning, to help ensure people have a safe, secure and affordable place to live. So, going to bring in John.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks again for the invitation to attend the committee today. So, from you know, from my perspective, the problem that we have is one of availability. So, it's a supply issue, and that's particularly in the main cities, you know, Edinburgh and Glasgow, over the last 10 to 15 years. So, we've had increasing demand because we've had an increase in population. The number of households has risen even faster because we've got fallen average household size. And we've had rising numbers, particularly of young people, coming into the main cities for economic opportunities. And they've got a greater propensity to be in the PRS. We've also had a slowing down and then an increase in social housing provision. We've had new build housing falling back from levels of 25,000 units a year back in 2007-2008.
Thanks very much. I'm sorry, I'm just going to interrupt because we do have lots of questions, and my question initially was around the rent control area provision in the bill. So if we could go there, that would be interesting to hear your perspective.
Yeah. I mean, it's just to set some of the context that it's a supply problem, and the affordability is a or affordability issues are a symptom of that. So we need to do something about the supply. And a big win is to try and get the pension funds and the BTR sector into providing housing in a big way in Scotland, like they do in parts of England, including in Manchester. And they're looking for index-linked returns in order to pay the pension liabilities at the back end. Now, a potential scenario, if you are a BTR investor, from looking at the bill, is that it could be the rent freeze could be in a particular area 0% in perpetuity. So if you're modelling, as we do model for some of the BTR funds, if you're modelling potential scenarios, that's a potential that's in the bill. And you won't just fail to make a return or a yield in order to pay your pension liabilities with that type of rent control. You're talking about the value of your asset eroding over your whole period. So no one's going to invest on that basis.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I think I'm going to bring in my second question because we've started to get into other areas here. And actually, this is specifically for... this is specifically for Hearthstone Investments and Dowbury. So you've both made the points that rent controls can be workable, and I'd be interested to hear from you both more detail on how rent controls could be acceptable to institutional investors. So maybe if I can start with Robin.
Hi, good morning. Thank you for the opportunity to speak in Convener Committee. Thank you also for the opportunity to join remotely. The starting point is we've already got rent control. Rent control was introduced in the 2016-2017 by way of rent pressure zones. It's just that we've never properly used it, and we've never properly used it because we didn't manage to collect the data. So when we look at the bill this time round, I've been involved in BTR since 2012, been self-employed since 2017. Most of my work has been in this sector. And the predominant message from investors, developers, operators across the spectrum is that the bill is workable with three main fixes. The first fix is to simplify rent control significantly and introduce a mechanism of inflation-permitted uplifts with caps. The second point is to remove rent control between tenancies, because that's a barrier to improvements and upgrades, and it's also a constraint on investment and therefore a constraint on the delivery of more homes. And the third point is collect the data. And I watched some of the sessions from last week, and across all the sessions, this point keeps coming back. But we need real rental data to inform decisions and ensure that future legislation is evidence-based. And when it comes to the data, I think there's three points. We need to work and be clear about how we're acquiring the data. We need to be clear about how we're analysing the data. And we then need to be clear about how we're applying the data. And I'm sure we'll come on to that later. But the summary point about making rent controls that work is work on what we've got with the rent pressure zones, which was inflationary permitted uplifts. Investors were starting to come into the market and getting comfortable with that. The few developments that we've seen come through have worked through that regime in that form of rent control. So let's use that as a starting point as to where we can evolve and if there needs to be changes. But the changes that have been proposed on the table just now are a complete barrier to investment. And we've got, I think John Retty's research showed there's £3.2 billion worth of investment, which could deliver 17,000 or more homes, that is just simply not coming to Scotland because of the proposals in the bill.
Okay, thanks very much for that. And Cedric, what's your perspective from Hearthstone?
Good morning, and thanks also for inviting us. Just very briefly, Hearthstone Investments, we manage about 1,800 homes across Scotland, England, Wales in the private rented sector. The capital we manage is on behalf of local common pension schemes. In Scotland specifically, we manage a housing fund for Scotland just for one Scottish local pension scheme. And that fund has been running since 2014. So we're one of the pioneers in that kind of BTR sector. I think the current bill is poorly designed. But as you say, we are not in principle against rent controls. They can work. I think what we need to accept is that the way the rental market operates is you have inflation driving everything. Inflation, if we have, let's say, 3%, 4% inflation, on average, wages grow by inflation. If rents increase by inflation, and rents increase by inflation, renters' affordability remains the same. So for the renters, that's fair, and they have a secure home they can afford. For landlords, if they can increase their rents by inflation, it means their maintenance fees, their cost of labour, the cost of debt, on average, also increase with inflation, and their position remains the same. For investors, if inflation is at, say, 3-4%, they earn 3-4% more in terms of pounds. The values of properties goes up roughly by the same level. Their net return remains at the 4-4.5% they expect. So this is a very delicate ecosystem, but if rent controls are implemented with that in mind, where they're pegged against inflation, the system works. The minute we start poking at this in any shape or form, it breaks down. It's a very delicate ecosystem. And the result of that is what we've seen in the last few years, that effectively no new supply of new energy-efficient homes is coming into the market, which results in the Scottish housing market being energy inefficient. We have old homes that are not being upgraded because landlords can't afford to invest. New investors are walking away. They stop investing. No net zero homes have been built because of that. And tenants face long queues. They face times without knowing where they can live because there's no supply. So everyone is worse off. And investors will just go to other markets, whether that's England, Wales, or internationally. So I think that we'll probably talk about the uncertainty we have, which is a prolonged uncertainty, which is another topic. But ultimately, I think more research needs to be done. And I've read the minutes from last week into what has worked and what hasn't worked internationally, because that's what investors look at. And where rent controls have worked is where rents can plus minus increase with inflation. And that also then helps tenants and avoids to weed out some of those incredible rent increases. So someone last week mentioned 40%. We don't want that. That's not in our interest. We want to retain our tenants. We want them to be able to stay in their homes for as long as they can. We didn't lose a single tenant during the pandemic because we worked with them through their financial struggles. We didn't evict tenants during the cost of living crisis. We want them to stay. We work with them. If they have financial struggles, we speak with them face to face. We want them to help. But if we are faced with a system where we potentially have 0% rental growth, which is completely unpredictable, I can't go out to investors and raise more capital to build more homes in Scotland. It's the end. There's nothing we can do. So okay. That's our top-down view on rent controls and the current proposals.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. So can I just clarify, because my question was about how rent controls could be acceptable to institutional investors. So basically you're saying link it to inflation.
Yep, yep. That's as simple as that. It's not very complicated. Yeah. Yep. If we do that, then we weed out all the excessive rent increases whilst keeping investors and landlords on board.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Gordon, do you want to come in on a supplementary?
Yeah, I've got a couple of questions.
Yep, please do.
Okay, thanks very much. Good morning, panel. I'll come to you first, Cedric, because it's in a similar area. You were talking about you have to accept reasonable rent increases. In my constituency of Edinburgh Pentlands, a social rented two-bedroom property is £450. Across the landing, same property in the same building is round about £1,100 to £1,200. If we didn't have proper rent controls in place, surely that gap's just going to get wider.
I can't comment on sorry.
Okay.
Unmuted. Yeah. So I think we're trying to get a bill that works for the private rented sector overall. Our rents that we charge are fair and they're affordable. Our aim is that rents don't make up more than 30% of someone's income, and we achieve that. We increased rents in line with what people can afford. We perform tenant satisfaction surveys. Our target is that 90% of our tenants are happy with the service they receive and the rents that we're charging. And if it drops below 90%, we check very carefully why that is. So we've got happy tenants that can afford their rents. 25% are key workers, and those who are not key workers have jobs in services, in retail, carpenters, forklift drivers. The market can work for everyone, but it needs to work for everyone. And just putting the pedal down on rents is not going to help, I'm afraid. I think, again, someone mentioned Berlin. It didn't work at all. It just didn't work. And I think we need to learn those lessons. I think if I could say one more thing. I think we need a strong private sector and a strong public sector in terms of housing. Most developments, as you know, provide public and private rented homes and owner-occupied homes on the same development. And if investment comes in for the private sector, that helps the developer and it supports additional social housing as well. It's an ecosystem that needs to work in balance. But simply putting the foot down on one part of the equation is going to not help. It's going to harm everyone.
You've touched upon how attractive it is for institutional investors, and you commented that you have the Housing Fund for Scotland on behalf of Falkirk Council Pension Scheme. Now, you invested £25 million of a £30 million drawdown in 2016, I think it was, and it was valued at £25.3 million in 2017. According to your March 24, the value of that fund has dropped dramatically at the same time as house prices have increased by 55% in the Falkirk area in the same time period. How attractive is investing in the private let sector in Scotland?
Well, I think your numbers are inaccurate to start with. The investment has been
very
attractive.
You're off your website.
Well, all I can say, the fund has been and is very attractive to investors. But we, at the moment, are unable to attract new investors because of the regulatory uncertainty. I think if we don't have an open dialogue between investors and the regulator, it's very, very hard, because in other markets, it's easier. So I think, yeah.
Okay.
Our investors are happy with their returns. If we start, we're approaching other local government pension schemes, they say, well, let's just wait until we have a partnership between the government and investors to build a sector that works for everyone. But if we have this type of dialogue and animosity, then I can't raise any more capital to invest in more Scottish housing. And that doesn't benefit anyone.
Okay.
Yeah, we've tried to buy net zero homes a couple of years ago in Scotland. There would have been another 20, 25 million. And then the rent freezes came out and we invested in England. I don't want to do that. I want to invest in Scotland. I think there's a big opportunity. There's a big need for new housing. But we need to work together. And that kind of animosity is not going to help anyone.
Okay. I've got a quick question for John Blackwood. John, you said that 1 in 10 of your members that took part in the survey were thinking about leaving the rented sector. What happens to the property when somebody leaves? It doesn't lie empty. It either gets sold back to the council, if it's an ex-council property, it then re-enters into the social rented sector at an extremely lower level of rent, as I've already indicated, or it gets sold in the normal rules of supply and demand. As the more properties in the market, the lower the market price. So given that in Scotland, if you check the national records for Scotland, there is 120,000 more homes than households, where's the issue?
Okay, can I address a point? First of all, you were saying it wasn't 1 in 10 were exiting the sector, it's 1 in 10 were saying it was no longer economically viable for them to continue in the sector. And indeed, I'm happy to share all the figures with you if it's of help to you in the future. You are right, and of course, the question is often raised that, yes, OK, a landlord might well sell for a variety of reasons, but the property is never lost. Somebody's still going to be living in that property. And I think that's the point that you're making. And that's very true. And of course, what we try and do as landlords and as an organisation representing landlords and letting agents, we are speaking to our agent members in particular, saying, are you monitoring where these properties are going to? Mm-hmm. And they're coming back from purely a business interest saying, yes, we are. And actually, it's going to owner-occupiers. And a lot of the time, it's young people buying their first property. And that's fantastic for those people who can afford to do that and who choose to do that. The issue is it's lost to the rented sector. So we're not seeing the sell back to local authorities that we would like to see.
But that first-time buyer could be somebody coming out of a rented sector
who's
a first-time buyer and then releasing a property.
Or indeed living at home, as many people are living with their parents much longer now than before to save up for a deposit. So yes, of course, it's still home to someone.
Yeah.
Our interest is, of course, looking at the private rented sector in particular, the wider rented sector. We don't have enough rented homes available for people to live in, and that's our concern going forward. And we can just see that pool diminishing as we speak. So I think there's a bigger policy issue. What can we do to address that so there's more renting opportunities for people in the future?
Okay.
Can I return to a point that you made earlier about two properties in the Stair?
Mm-hmm.
And again, that's often mentioned as an issue. You've got two identical properties on the face of it, but of course, vastly different rents. One's in the social rented sector and one's in the private rented sector. What we're not taking into account is, of course, the cost to those landlords in question.
Mm-hmm.
So the cost to a private landlord, whether it's an institutional investor or, for my members, largely individuals, is vastly different. So taxation, for a start, of course, that landlord's taxed in a very different way to the social landlord is. Borrowing, the availability of cash and what that actually costs. Labour costs as well, too. You're subject to the open market for your local plumbers, tradespeople, local authorities and housing associations tends to have their own in-house tradespeople. So their costs, their labour costs are much smaller. And of course, in the private rented sector, we could be offering furnished accommodation, which of course is not happening in the social rented sector. So I know in the face of it, you might think that we're comparing apples with apples, but I don't think we are, because the cost to the end the end landlord is vastly different. I think the bigger issue is that affordable to the tenant? And how can we make housing across the piece, all tenures, more affordable? And I think that's in all of our interests, round this table and everybody giving evidence as well too, because we want a sector where we have tenants who can live in a place that they call home, that they feel secure in to call home for as long as they like. As landlord investors, we want that too. We don't want properties to be unaffordable to our tenant customers. That just doesn't make good business sense for us too. And I guess that goes back to the point that has already been made that, you know, costs do go up, rents will go up, but how can we make it perhaps more stable, more predictable in the future? And linking that to inflation would be an ideal solution. Maybe not the only solution, but certainly one that would be more sensible and more sustainable for the sector in the long term.
Okay. So I'm going to bring in Timothy, and then we're going to move to question. We're going to have to move to question three because we've been on half an hour for the first two questions. So Timothy.
Well, just going to quickly build on what John was saying. Exactly my thoughts were. I think it's wrong to compare the social rented sector to the private rented sector. I've just jotted down, you know, social rented, the landlord will get direct payments in terms of universal credit. The right to buy has been abolished to preserve stock. Why don't we abolish the 6% ADS to preserve stock in the PRS? The cost of living caps were lifted and still not and not comparable to private rented sector. The business models as well isn't taken into consideration for private landlords. And with this quest to net zero minimum energy efficiency standards, social landlords can get access to a grant funding of £200 million. Are we going to offer that to private landlords when they can only get a loan of up to £15,000? Where's that money going to go? But the fundamental, go back to the first point I made, we've got to review the taxes and costs that are impacting private landlords to get a grip on the supply and the investment. A private landlord, a new entrant to the market, average property price in Scotland, roughly £185,000, with 6% ADS, they're paying just under £12,000 in tax. So they've got to have that money to start off with, or where's that money going to go? Bolt the 15K loan for energy efficiency onto that. You're talking big, big cash just to be a private landlord, and a private landlord is a housing provider. So we need to start treating them that way. So I think it's a very dodgy territory to start comparing both sectors.
Thanks very much for that. Thank you. Pam, can you bring in question three? I'm really keen to get Anna in on the conversation.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I have a couple of questions on the rural area, but we'll start with Anna. Could you comment in more detail as to how the private rented sector is different in the rural areas? And do you believe that the housing bill is too focused on addressing the needs of urban areas versus the rural areas?
Thank you, and thank you very much for inviting Scottish Land and Estates to contribute today. Just as a wee backdrop for anyone who might not know, but Scottish Land and Estates members are a principal provider of housing in rural Scotland, supplying homes to 13,000 families across the area. So this bill is a big deal for rural landlords. The key issue is, of course, uncertainty. And that's one thing that rural landlords have in common with urban landlords, is they are faced with uncertainty just like anyone else. But arguably that uncertainty is much greater because in rural environments, the whole owning property, providing property, is not a profit-led business. It comes historically off the back of employment. It has remained, in the main, a key element of the rural economy. Basically, so long as there are houses in rural areas, there's places for the employees to live. This is a major issue at the moment. There's major recruitment problems in rural areas because there's not enough housing. So then if we look at the bill and the impacts of the bill, and rent controls particularly, there's so much uncertainty over the provisions that are generated by these provisions, no less started by that 0% that sort of jumps out from the page. When your profit margins are so small and you've got massive costs that urban landlords just have no concept of. Yeah, the whole housing provision thing is not really something that you're going to be that endeared to. I want to give you an example of some costs. So with rural property, you have things to deal with, such as the properties are on average 30% larger. That's typically because they're traditional, quite often detached, quite often single storey. That makes them more expensive to maintain and upgrade. Quite often, as a rural landlord, you've got a track and a road to keep intact to get to the property. That's something that urban landlords, or very few, have to consider. Trades. There's a very severe shortage and so limited competition, and so the cost of getting a tradesman is not in an uncompetitive environment. I mean, the idea that you have to get three quotes for something is just laughable. Quite a few farms and estates have to provide electricity through private wire. That's basically where the electricity comes to the main farm, and then it's taken off from the meter there to the properties. Private wire is offered, it can only be serviced through commercial contracts. Commercial electricity is extortionate compared to domestic electricity. Who picks up the extra cost? It's the rural landlord. There's also private sewage, because very few rural properties are on the mains. There's private water supplies. Now, let's drill down in private water supplies. There are 23,000 private water supplies throughout Scotland. This is the rule rather than the exception. Private water supplies are heavily regulated. Annual testing is required. Filtration, treatment plants all come at costs which depend on the water source, the geology — you don't get to choose your geology, by the way — and other interfering factors. And these costs can range from a couple of £100 per annum to thousands of pounds per annum. There's one Borders farm that has been trying to sort out the water supply so that their six cottages can actually pass the test. They've so far invested — they've actually lost count, but it is between £75,000 and £100,000. And that's before the annual running costs. I think they're three boreholes in, but the water keeps failing the test, even though the farm operated perfectly fine off the springs previously. But because of the high standard required by the testing regime, they're just constantly failing. Another property in South Argyll, they are suffering annual costs per cottage of £740. And that's because of the mineral content in the water that keeps up clogging up the filtration systems. And they've just got this constant cost. I actually put that example in our response to the call to views. And, you know, what they're doing is they're sort of sucking up this extra cost because they've got the benefit of income from a wind farm. But what he said to me is, the thing is, like, we're one of the few lucky ones. You know, there's thousands of other farms like us that don't have wind farms, will never be able to have a wind farm, and so they don't have that extra income. So these are just some examples of just how different it is being a rural landlord to an urban landlord. The cost base is entirely different. You provide housing in rural areas as a service and as a need for your employees. You don't provide housing in rural areas for profit. And that's probably why you do not get large institutional investors diving into the rural property world.
No, thank you, Anna. Does anybody else want to say anything on that? No. I can go into my supplementary question. Depopulation is a serious issue in rural areas. I know personally, because I spoke to 31 councils, 32 chief execs, and the ones in the rural areas mentioned that depopulation is a problem. And we've also heard it in the committee here today, this year as well. Do you believe that the rent control provisions in the Housing Bill risk decreasing the supply of homes in rural areas and thus discouraging population growth?
In a word, yes, and it all comes down to that other word, uncertainty. What they need is certainty. The issue with rent controls is it's all about the incentive to be that provider, that incentive to bring forward projects, work in partnership with others to develop housing. Now, I've just been working with the Highlands and Islands Regional Economic Partnership on a survey, and we've surveyed the membership of Scottish Land Estates in the Highlands and Islands area, and it was really interesting getting all that information back. But in a nutshell, there is a real appetite for landowners and farmers to provide more housing and to keep delivering housing in the Highlands and Islands area. The data is very clear there. However, they're being held back by this uncertainty, and it's this whole disincentive, all about, well, if we do this, where are the goalposts going to be next time? When you look at the Rural and Islands Housing Fund, they put conditions on the grant funding. And so if you take money from that grant to deliver your affordable housing, it's all fine and dandy. And then what happened with COLA? The rent cap comes along. So they can't put up their rents in line with what their projections were, which were in line with the the local social housing, which was what it's all linked to. The social housing could go up, but they couldn't put their rents up. And you see, that all just is a big disincentive. Why would you take out the Rural Housing Fund grant if you weren't going to and be committed to providing affordable rents, if you weren't going to be treated with the same protections as the social rented sector? And I think that's really a really important point, because if housing delivery is so important, which it absolutely is, to counter rural depopulation, this imbalance needs to be addressed. And it goes very much to what both John and Timothy were saying about taxation, all these sort of things. You know, for rural housing providers, providing housing at affordable rents is pretty normal. You know, it doesn't take much digging around to see that actually the local market is the affordable rent market. You know, they're all pretty much a similar price, and particularly the more remote you get. And so it's really important to make sure that in any provisions for rent caps and things like that, that anyone providing housing at an affordable rent is not restricted in a way that puts them at a disadvantage to even the social housing sector. And actually, on that point that Mr. McDonald made about, so housing sold out of the private rented sector, it's okay because someone else moves in. Well, it's not okay if there's not more housing coming in to fill that void. You've got to have the increase in housing. This emergency is all about a shortage in housing. Rent controls is symptomatic treatment of the housing shortage, and that is what's got to be addressed.
Thank you, Anna. Just my last question, just rolling on from the depopulation, is that we all know that in our rural areas, we're very lucky that a lot of our sectors like space and energy are growing. And I've certainly spoke to chief execs in relation to that, and they're talking about employability and bringing people in from other countries and sometimes even England. And to stay in these rural areas, do you think employability will be affected by these rent controls in the housing bill as well?
I think what needs to be addressed is the incentivisation. So if the housing can be delivered because everything's set right in terms of people's, the cash flows are protected, they know that they're going to be able to pay off the bank debt or whatever from delivering the housing. If that is set right, you know, what Cedric was saying about making sure that things are kept in check with inflation, the housing delivery should come, and therefore there'll be homes for these people to live in. But at the moment, so long as there aren't homes for these people to move into, you know, you've got to ask the question, where are they going to live? How are we going to get this transmission rolled out? How are people going to, you know, take up the jobs at the Freeports and everything? So it's really important that we don't cut off our noses despite our faces, and everything is looked at holistically. And, you know, the areas are treated as individual areas, and it's not a one-size-fits-all approach.
Thank you. I think John wanted to come on.
Yeah, again, just to build on Anna's point there, as the Scottish Association of Landlords, we've been approached by a number of local business groups and local enterprise trusts, saying that there's a major concern that they have, that they want to encourage people to live in rural Scotland and to move to rural Scotland and set up business, develop local businesses as part of that community. But of course, they're unable to do so because there's just not enough homes for people to live in. So they're saying, how can we get the private rented sector to provide the homes so that people can relocate to this area? So in order for them to achieve that economic development in their local communities, they're relying on people commuting from our major urban cities and towns. And that's surely wrong, that we should be trying to encourage people to relocate and provide the housing that Anna's been talking about locally. We hear a lot about what's happening in the south of Scotland and how the challenges in that area are preventing local economic development. But that could be said for any rural area in Scotland. And we can't see the housing or the private rented sector in isolation. It's very much an integral part of our local economy, and we need to protect it.
Thank you.
I'll bring in John, and then I'm going to move on and bring in Miles.
Yeah, just a brief point on the depopulation issue. And you know, what has been, BTR might not be being successfully being provided in rural areas, but mid-market rent is. So we've seen successful provision of mid-market rent in areas like Dumfries and Galloway, throughout the Highlands, by the likes of the Highlands Housing Association. And the rent control regime, again, that's proposed in the bill, I think the RSL sector will tell you that that's going to make their investment programme in these areas much more difficult.
Miles.
Good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us here and online. I wanted to ask a question and maybe an added bit to that question. Firstly, with regard to some of the evidence which the committee's heard from tenant groups who have said that the proposals place too much onus on tenants to challenge rents in rent control areas. So just wondered if you agree with this and whether or not the onus should be on landlords to comply with that rent control area. And wanted to also ask your opinion with regards to the numbers of reviews of rents now taking place. We've done a number of panels recently, and it's quite clear actually from some of the more rural evidence we've received that this has now become almost an annual review of rents, whereas previously it wasn't. So just wondered another unintended consequence and whether or not you had any data on that question as well.
I don't have hard facts, but the anecdotal evidence is very clear that rural landowners and landlords are basically now following an annual rent review regime, whereas they might not have before. Now, this is quite particular because rural tenancies tend to be much longer lasting. So, you know, a tenant staying for 10 years plus is very normal. You know, many are in for decades. And so you can imagine where the open market rent sits if you started back then, but you weren't doing regular rent reviews. You know, that's probably part of the reason why rents are actually so low in rural areas. And so once you put in, start doing your annual rent reviews, you're slowly going to be clawing up. But what you're not getting in rural areas is that 40% wham, because they want the tenant to stay. They don't want to send out, you know, Mrs. Brown, who's been there for 20 years and been the, you know, the best tenant ever, who babysits the children and is, you know, a player in the community. They want them to stay. But rent reviews are now happening regularly.
Anyone else?
If I can maybe just add to that, certainly we've done some research, obviously, from our own members on this very subject. And from those who responded to our surveys, we have found that 45% of respondents have increased their rent during 2023. and that was compared to only 8% in 2022. So just to concur with your point there, we are seeing a natural annual increase of rents, and we continue to see that for the foreseeable. So, and of course, that's all been introduced as a result of the new private residential tenancy, which we did say would be an unintended consequence of that limit of rent increases to once every 12 months, effectively becomes a licence to increase every 12 months. And the sector's responding to that now.
Yes, thank you, Mars. Just to build on that, and then just going back to the provisions in the bill, I think, it goes back to that lack of understanding. You know, the periodic assessment of rent conditions will collect information on the rent payable and the rate of increase, but it's not collecting any data on the reason for that increase. So we could amend the rent notice under the PRT to include a reason, and then in Section 15, Part 1, where the local authority has to collect information, there could be a reason for that rent increase. And why is that important? Because it's that understanding of all these costs and taxes and why, what's happening in the market. And actually, if the reason for rent increases was collected up until when the Cost of Living Act was introduced, then I think it would have made for a better policy, because there would have been better understanding about some of the costs that landlords are facing, and therefore there may have been, okay, we can see what's happening in all parts of the market. So I think the reason for any rent increases, collecting that in this bill is really important going forward.
I would just add one brief point, I think, to that. You know, the system that we have at the moment with landlord registration, some people have suggested that we just kind of tool that up a bit. But landlord registration, I led the evaluation of it for the Scottish Government, you know, a number of years ago, and it's a monitoring system. It's not really there with enforcement powers. Local authorities don't tend to use it to enforce good landlord behaviours. Allowing the rent data to be monitored through landlord registration, really, I think, is going to be of limited benefit unless there are some enforcement powers. And it's really with enforcement that you ensure compliance. So we've got to look at a model a bit like the Residential Tenancies Board in the Republic of Ireland. So that's nationally funded. It's got a monitoring purpose, it's got an analytical purpose, including reviewing reasons for rent increases in certain areas, and it's also got a compliance and enforcement function.
Thinking about that and the rent control areas, how would you think that will work in Edinburgh in practice? You know, very different markets in different parts of the city. An overheated market, I think most people would except. So, you know, we've seen in different countries rent controls being suspended, but then different models brought forward. We've got that patchwork quilt of what we've done as a country, let's face it, to date, and just wondered what model you would then think could work going forward. Because I think that's one of the things the bill has included bits and pieces from previously, but there's maybe an opportunity to open this up to get something which will work in the Scottish context, for especially what we've heard today about rural and urban communities. But Edinburgh is maybe a very specific case, given the increases we've seen.
Shall I kick off on that? So you're right, it is very complicated, and we should be doing a proper cost-benefit analysis of the introduction of these sets of measures, both nationally and locally, which currently is kind of absent. The points that were made, I think, by Robin and Cedric earlier, I think I would agree with. So you have some kind of cap and collar approach on rent setting. So a number of the BTR funds, for example, they have a model within tenancies of either CPI or 5%, whichever is lower. Within tenancies. So between tenancies, you're still allowed the opportunity to reset, because I think, as Robin has mentioned, that allows you to upgrade and to improve the properties. So moving towards a system on that type of basis, as you do in some of the as you do in some other countries internationally. I think you will find within the investment sector that there is a kind of a broad support.
Degay, did you want to come in?
Yes, on the landlord register. First of all, I think that any rent control has got to be based on really, really good data, and this is something that Scottish Land and Estates has been calling for. I have reservations over the landlord register because, as John's alluded to, it wasn't designed for this purpose, and it is essentially a monitoring system, and it's quite basic. It is a register of owners of let property. It is not a register of landlords who let property. And that's a really important distinction here. And just to sort of throw this into the rural sector, when you then start looking at agricultural holdings, you have tenant farmers who let out properties, but they're not compelled to be on the register because they're basically subletting a property. It is the owner of the property that has to be on the register. Now, it's been argued that, okay, but they can be down as an agent, but that's just nonsense because the responsibility should lie with the relevant landlord, not the person that in theory is being paid to do the letting, but the tenant farmer isn't. They're choosing to do the letting. So the landlord register needs to be sorted so that it is the relevant landlord that is registered, not the owner. And I mean, I don't know what it's like in the urban world, but it's quite conceivable that you have buildings that are sublet. I'd love to know who's registered there. You know, I'll just throw that one out there.
No, that's a good point.
Yeah, so when you then look at the data on the landlord register, obviously at the moment it's just a sort of do you meet the repairing standard. There is scope that you could expand that system, that when you sign up to it and everything, and then you could upload documents and things, say, yep, here's my EPC, here's my electricity certificate, all of that. You know, there is scope to have something like that, and the tenants would like that, because then it's a really explicit way of inspecting to see, actually, does my landlord have these documents? That's just an idea. But I think that in terms of the data collection broadly, scarcity of data is going to be a real issue. And also, I worry about the list of criteria in the bill because it's a very urban tenement-centric list. Mm. There's no gardens, there's no balconies, there's no pony fields, there's no extras that all impact the value of a property. It doesn't have to get to that property, you've got to go along a 5-mile bumpy track, and you definitely need to own a 4-wheel drive. You know, all these things play into the value of rental properties. Anyway, I'll get off my thoughts there.
For saying things, but I do need to just say that we've got about half an hour left. I'm really keen to bring in some other members who haven't had a chance to speak. I've got a stack of people that have said they want to come in on this area, so I'm just going to say please try to keep your responses succinct as possible and come in really if you're just bringing something really new into the conversation at this point, because we need to get through some things. So I saw Robin online, you wanted to come in a wee while ago. John, I think you indicate, John Blackwood, you indicated you wanted to come in. And then I've got my colleague Gordon MacDonald indicating maybe a supplementary, but very short. So let's go with that and see how we get on. And then I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey. Oh, and I'm actually going to go back and maybe pick up on one of Miles's questions. So we've got quite a lot to do, and we've still got quite a lot to cover. So, Robin, come on in.
Thank you, Convener, and I'll try and respect the time. It's going back to Mr. Bridges' question about the application of locally and nationally. Very simplistically, I think the approach here, as has already been mentioned, investors need clarity, certainty, and consistency. The challenge of each local authority is collecting rent and applying rent and interpreting rent in different ways. There's a real issue with clarity and consistency, and that could put investors off coming to Scotland. So an approach there, as John has mentioned, mentioning the Irish model of having a national agency, maybe extended from Rent Service Scotland, but having a national agency to collect the data, analyse the data, apply the data, that then local authorities draw down on, would seem to me to be the most appropriate way of applying the rent controls locally, but having transparency nationally. And I think also from a resource perspective from local authorities, and we know from some committee papers that they've submitted that they've got a real issue with rent collection, having that resource nationally and across the board, I think would provide much better clarity and consistency. Hope that was short enough.
Okay, thank you very much for that. John Blackwood.
Yeah, I think just to pick up on Miles's question again, I think the bill is trying to find a solution to a problem that we don't fully understand. That's the issue here. Your substantive question was about why should it be for a tenant to challenge the rent increase, or the onus is always on them to do something about it. I think there is a greater need for transparency across the whole sector, and it's going back to the point I think we're all making. We need to have better data. So we do need to have a rent register of some kind so that everybody can see exactly what rents are being charged and why they're being charged and the variances within local authority areas as well as the wider Scottish area. So I think we need to grapple with that. I think we need to understand the problem before we try and find these solutions through rent controls. We're hearing landlords equally saying, what is the market value of a property in my area? They don't know it any more than what the tenants do. So everybody's really grappling about trying to find data, which surely is something as government we can try and pull together and create and make available so that local authorities can actually make informed decision based on real data.
Okay, great, thanks. Gordon, very brief supplementary.
Yeah, very quickly. John, if I picked you up correctly, you said to your earlier numbers that in 2022, 8% of people put their rent up, and in 2023, that was 23%.
45%.
Well, that's even worse. How much of that was due to the fact that there was a rent cap and a rent freeze in place because of COVID?
I don't know is the answer to that question, and I'm sure it would have been a major factor. Yeah. So, you know, we've seen... Certainly this has become the normal practice, and I think that's what we're alluding to earlier. So are we seeing rent increases as part of the standard practice in the private rented sector on an annual basis? Yes, we are. And I think our figures are showing that that wasn't the case before. So comparing it even to figures in 2022 at 8%, within a year, that was 45%. So I think we can draw a conclusion that it is a result of rent caps.
But there was a form of rent control in place at the time when it was 8%, not when there was a time when it was 45%.
No, there was when it was 45%, but maybe not when it was 8%. So the rent caps are still in existence until the end of March.
3%.
Were still in existence. Well, it was a rent freeze, then it was capped at the 3%. So yes, you know, I think a lot of landlords maybe had already raised their rents. So the 12-month period, remember, there's always going to be potentially a year lag before you could increase it again. So certainly, I think it's fair to say that rent control has, or the rent caps that were introduced, has increased rents in Scotland. There's no question about that.
But just to jump in there, the average rents in Scotland are the highest across the UK, and we've had rent controls in place. So, again, moving on with this legislation, I don't think we fully know the impact of the Cost of Living Act. I mean, we do, but I'm not quite sure policymakers do. And surely that needs to form part of this conversation as well.
OK, Anna, you indicated you want to come in very briefly, and then I'm going to go to Willie Coffey.
Yeah, just very, very quickly, and this all ties into transparency of information, and the concern is that the provisions are change of tenancy. The exemptions don't really allow or they might not allow for, you know, the important things that do impact on value. And so it's really just to say that I think that anything that's got a material change to a property needs to be exempt and treated as a new-to-market property, because otherwise it comes down to transparency. You know, you're comparing apples with pears and things like that. And so I think that exemptions need to be looked at in the wider scheme of all this data collection, and Yeah, maybe it is a case that actually we just need to put the brakes on, get a really good data collection system in place, and then see where we stand. Because then we'll be able to develop something that's much, much better because we've got the information. It's a little bit cart before horse.
OK, thank you. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, everybody. Convener, it's maybe just worth reminding ourselves that the bill makes a provision for rent control areas to be established, but only on the recommendation of the local council to Scottish ministers. I wanted to just ask Anna, does that give you, Anna, some comfort that in the rural communities, particularly in the Borders, that Borders Council, in looking at those issues that you've described early on there, would be more or less likely to be minded to declare rent control areas in that particular area for the reasons that you've explained? Do you get any comfort from that flexibility that the bill proposes?
I think it comes down to data and scarcity of data. The Scottish Borders, Dumfries and Galloway, the whole borderlands, that area has got a population that is so spread out. And so the data is all over the place. You know, if you go on to any of the letting portals and see what's available, you'll be lucky if across the whole region you get even, you know, half a dozen properties up. The number of letting properties available are so low, which is a reflection on supply, but also that reflects on how much data is available. And so if you don't even know where your market's sitting, you know, and you're relying on data of tenancies that's all sitting in long-standing tenancies, you know, it's going to be really, really hard to actually pinpoint exactly where that dividing line is between the area that needs rent control and the area that doesn't. And then you've got to think about the knock-on effect in the boundaries of that area. Mm-hmm. So I think that comfort's not really the word that I would associate with it.
OK. In order for our council to make such a determination to declare or request a rent control area, it's going to rely on some kind of data set. And you've spoken at length about what that might look like and the sparsity of that in the area that you principally represent. So could maybe wider for the panel, what kind of data do we need to be gathering to make sure that you know, I think it was Robin that said, in order to inform the decisions, we've got to have an evidence base behind it. So what kind of data sets do we need to make sure that it's fair and that the council can make a reasonable assessment of whether to have a thing like a rent control area in their council area? John, you want to have a go?
Yeah, I'm happy to jump in. I think probably the other John's better answering your question when it comes to data than me. But certainly from our perspective, one of the big issues we have is understanding what passing rents are, current rents, and how that compares to market rents. So what is that disparity? So, and let's understand why that's the case. It's not the case everywhere in Scotland. And I think one of the advantages of the bill is that it's not looking at a blanket rent control for the whole of Scotland. And I think that's a good thing. So it's going to be localised. It will be based on data, however we calculate that data and gather that data, and on local needs. So, and that's for our local authorities, hopefully, to determine. But I think there is a big issue about, it's all very well analysing rent as a whole, but thinking, you know, what landlords charge to existing tenants is very different quite naturally to what they would charge if they were taking on a new tenant and bringing it to the open market.
Thanks, John. Dr. Boyle, what kind of data set do we need to make sure that there's fairness and balance within this proposal?
Yeah, look, I mean, I've just noted down a few examples, but I think John's captured a couple of the main ones, but actual rents, which we don't really have at the moment, as well as the advertised rents, information on supply and availability. You know, we don't, in any area of Scotland, including the whole of Scotland, we don't even know what the stock of supply is. So when you ask a basic question such as what's been the impact of the rent freeze on supply levels in Scotland, can't answer it really with any real authority. You can look at, you know, indicators like Scottish Household Survey and try to make estimates and Estimates do seem to suggest that supply has dropped since 2017 in Scotland by about 13%. But I can't be definitive on it because I don't really have the data on it. Knowing that information by house type as well, as well as by price band, having information, much more holistic information on housing need in those areas. So at the moment in housing needs and demand assessments, we tend to estimate housing needs by looking at overcrowded and concealed households. So you've got a, you know, that's quite a high, it's quite a high bar. Whereas work that we've done quite recently for Homes for Scotland showed that if you look at housing needs much more holistically, then about 28% of population of Scotland is in some form of acute housing needs. So that's looking at overcrowded and concealed, unfit properties, not able to afford, homelessness, etc. So some kind of audit of need and demand supply drivers as well within the market, because rent levels will respond to what demand supply is doing. How many people are coming into an area? What's the pipeline of new provision? Rents will likely respond, because the rental market is a very responsive market. It will respond to demand supply conditions. And just briefly to pick up, you asked the question earlier about areas like the Scottish Borders having, would have the powers to determine whether or not they have a rent control area. You would kind of hope in areas where, rents don't seem to be kind of spiralling out of control and there is an acute supply problem, that the local authority won't move to impose a rent control area. But if you're an investor and you're looking at a long-term hold, you don't have that level of certainty as to what the local authority is going to do over the short, the medium, or the longer term. But if you have the provision within the bill that's workable for the investor along the lines that we mentioned earlier about having the cap and the collar, then that's not then going to spook the investors to the same extent. At the moment, it's a lack of certainty about what might happen with a rent control regime. That's the problem.
Robin wanted to come in on that as well briefly. Thanks. Robin.
Yeah, sorry. Thank you, Convener. It's just a very quick point. In the commercial markets, whether offices, shops, industrial, even when we talk about residential from a commercial sense, we start on a rate per square foot. And the reason for that is it's a common denominator wherever you are in the country. Now, you can then enhance it because of views or amenities or whatever, but getting down to being able to understand one simple point comparing it on a like-for-like basis is a pretty good starting point for data collection. I realise that that probably won't apply to most of the rest of the viewing market, but I think from a baseline perspective, being able to compare something like-for-like, then getting down to a cost for the amount of floor area is a pretty good starting point.
That's very helpful. I just want to come back to John Boyle. You've used the term cap and collar a couple of times, and maybe it would be good if you could just unpack that a little bit, what you mean, because that seems to be maybe an industry expression, and I just want to make sure that everybody understands what you mean by that.
Yeah, I mean, it's a bit like how some of the BTR funds use rent controls within tenancies just now. So I gave an example, I think, earlier of inflation or 5%. Whatever is lower, so it can't go higher than that, and it can't go lower than this. So that's what the cap and the collar is alluding to.
Brilliant. Thank you very much for that, Willie. Do you have more? I think you've got more questions.
It's really John's kind of touched on the issue about national data collection that he prefer. It was Robin, I beg your pardon, that you talked about the preference to have national data collection to inform the whole rent control debate and issue and so forth. But just maybe to come back to Robin, how do we make sure that local circumstances are built into that, Robin? If we don't have localised data collection systems, how do we balance that up so that local circumstances can be taken into account? Robin.
I was just waiting to come off mute. Sorry, Mr. Coffin. I think the way that I would envisage that working is that the national agency data collection, whatever, takes all that data, analyses it, and then makes it available to the local authority. And the local authority then draws that down and they apply whatever mechanism it is that they have to ensure that local circumstances are taken into account. I mean, I think the whole data piece has been mentioned to others. There's a real job to be done here. but it's the foundation for everything that we're talking about. It's the foundation that, you know, the reason why rent pressure zones never worked is because we didn't collect the data. I've got a real, real fear that this housing bill, in 5 years' time, we're reviewing it and amending it because we don't have the data. There's a real proper job that needs to be done in designing that system and ensuring that all these things are properly considered. I'm sorry, I can't cover it just now, but I think a proper design of that system and ensuring it works for all is the way to go about it.
Lastly, any other views from our colleagues in the table about whether data collection should be national, local, or a little mixture of both, Anna?
I would say from, so I'm a chartered surveyor as well, and the from my background, you know, I've worked in the commercial sector through RESI, I'm obviously now in policy, but over the course of that, a national system is fine, but all these industries operate off local knowledge. So you have your, you know, your agents understand each area and they'll know that it's whatever square foot here and it's whatever square foot there. And they'll know that there's a physical barrier here that, creates that divide between that street and that street. Or, you know, in rural areas, it might be a range of hills, you know. Local knowledge is really important, even if it's a nationwide system. And I think that as good as AI could ever be, nothing can ever take away from the importance of the people on the ground. And I'm not saying necessarily agents, but you know, you've got your local councils that provide that local input as well. So I think that nationwide is fine, but not exclusively. As I say, one size doesn't fit all.
I'd agree. I think to try and ensure consistency and proper resourcing, I think it should be a national data set, but one that's capable of getting inputs from local authority level, as well as the ability to draw down the data at local authority level. So, you know, if you look at something like Registers for Scotland and house prices, so that's a national sales data set, and it will give you accurate information on house prices, transactions, market turnover at a national level, but it's also capable of doing it at a local authority level, at a data zone level, at a postcode level. So the ability to be able to drill down that national data set at the local authority level is very important for these types of provisions.
Thank you very much for your responses to those questions. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Mark Griffin, who's joining us online, and he's got questions in the area of eviction.
Thanks, Camilla. Before asking my questions, just declare a relevant interest that I was previously an owner of a private rented property up until July last year. I do have a couple of questions on the provisions in the bill around evictions. And my first one is to ask members of the panel what they think the impact might be of the bill's proposal that the tribunal will have to consider whether to delay an eviction and what impact that could potentially have on tenants and landlords. We'll come to John Blackwood first.
Okay, thank you very much for the question. I obviously need to state that I have an interest as being a tribunal member of the First Tier Tribunal Housing and Property Chamber. So I do sit in the First Tier Tribunal. Obviously, I'm speaking purely representing the Scottish Association of Landlords, and we already have serious concerns, and we've spoken to Mark and others, about the length of time it takes for cases to be heard by the tribunal. And will this have an impact on the ongoing tribunal? We imagine it will have. Of course it will have. It's putting more pressure on a tribunal system, which is, quite frankly, needing more resources to be able to continue to function. We are fully in support of the tribunal, but it has to function well. And that's, of course, for landlords and for tenants alike. So we do think there will be an overall impact as a direct result of this bill in the future. And that has to be taken into consideration.
Can I just come back just to the original question? The questioner was around the power for the tribunal to consider whether to delay an eviction and just the impact that might have on individual tenants and landlords.
I think certainly potentially Actually, there could be delays there. I don't think there's an issue about that. Of course, that's the intention of it. The tribunal already has that power, so it could delay that. It could do that at the moment. So it would have to obviously have regard to that with every case in the future. I think the knock-on consequence for both landlords and tenants is that that could mean a further delay, maybe even a further hearing to be able to consider that case. So there is the overall impact to the service, as well as, of course, to the landlords and tenants concerned.
Thanks. I don't know if Timothy or Anna have anything to add there before I move on to the next point.
Anna.
Yes. Thank you. So I would say that, just as John has said, that there is certainly... that, you know, there is already a system in place that allows delay. One of our members gave me an example just this week about a process they'd been going through, and it had taken 3 months to get to the tribunal, 3 months for the hearing, and then it was extended by 3 months. This was a rent arrears case that was already substantial, but 3 months down the line, that rent arrears grows. Now, you've got to ask the question, is that good for the tenant building up their debt? I mean, clearly it's not good for the landlord because, you know, the risk of them, you know, losing the money that's already indebted to them is great. But it's not great for the tenant either. And I think that there's two things here. The mental health side of both landlords and tenants when debt's involved is not great. But also that whole thing is you're creating a system potentially that allows tenants to build greater debt in a rent arrears situation. And I think that is just not healthy. The other thing is... I can't remember what it is, so I'll let someone else have a poll.
I'm sure it'll come back to you. We're going to actually have to move on. We're really getting very tight on time. I'm going to actually extend the panel maybe by an additional 20 to 25 minutes. Mark, did you have more questions?
Thanks, Fiona. My second question was around damages for illegal evictions and how they are being calculated. Now, the bill changes that, and the risk of challenge and penalty will be higher for landlords who evict illegally. And I just wonder if any members of the panel have any comments on the changes around this in the bill, and is this a method of improving potentially some poor practice that might exist in sector when it comes to illegal evictions?
Anybody want to pick that up? I don't want to stifle the conversation by bringing in the issue of time, so please do come in.
Okay. We have absolutely no objection to this proposal, so illegal eviction is not acceptable, and I think anything that could be done to enforce that is welcome.
Okay.
Yeah, I think
we
don't need on that as a panel.
You know, getting rid of there is a small but significant minority within the sector who, you know, engage in bad practices, and if we can use, you know, more effective legislation and regulation to get rid of them, I think you'll find broad support from those in the industry.
Okay, thanks very much. I've just been flagged to me, Timothy, that you might have wanted to say something around the powers for, well, it's kind of like increasing the layer of the tribunals delaying evictions.
Yeah, I think it was only to pick up on the whether in the bill that the seasonal a seasonal factor, and I just think there needs to just be some clarity there. I think in some of the policy work it was talking about delays during winter periods, but that seems to be expanded. So it's just, I think, some clarity on to give certainty to the sector if those periods are introduced and how long they can be introduced for. But I think, as Anna's alluded to, I suppose risks to landlords, increased and agents, increased cases of rent arrears could place more landlords in financial hardship. But of course, local authorities as well, they've got a legal right to house anyone with the threat of homelessness at any point throughout the year. So I think some clarity around that would be welcome.
Okay, thanks for that. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosol with the theme of joint tenancies. Pam.
Thank you, convener. This is a question probably for John Blackwood for the Scottish, from the Scottish Association of Landlords. In your submission, you expressed concerns about the unintended consequences of the proposal regarding how a joint tenancy can be ended when there is no mutual agreement. Could you explain your concern about this, particularly in relation to tenants of at risk of domestic abuse, and how would you like to see the bill being improved?
With regard, I think it's a complex issue and an area that we do need to investigate a little bit more. And we have consulted the Scottish Government on this and come up with various scenarios. We think that overall the solution would be allow tenants to be able to make an application to the first tier tribunal if they want to be released from that tenancy for whatever reason. We think that probably would be the more proportionate and easiest approach for all parties and for landlords too, in the sense of that an independent tribunal would be making that decision. The unintended consequence, you could have a party of three who have gone into a joint tenancy, so the three of them have entered into that joint contract, and then one wants to leave, but actually inadvertently the unintended consequence is, yes, that person could be allowed to walk away, but it could have the result of unintentionally making those other two people homeless, effectively, because they might not be able to afford that rent to continue to stay in the property. And the landlord obviously can't afford to reduce the rent to just have two people in a three-bedroom property. So that could result in the whole tenancy breaking down and all three having to move out of the property as opposed to just one. And we are, of course, aware that with domestic abuse, there could be issues here with regards to, of course, one party leaving and exerting control on the remaining tenant, because, of course, that could mean that they are no longer financially able to continue to live in that property. So it could be another way of coercive control of the exiting party, they are leaving that property. So overall, we've looked at scenarios. We're keen to discuss this more with the Scottish Government and indeed elected members, if you're interested in having that ongoing dialogue. But we think there's unintended consequences from this, which could result in more people becoming homeless rather than just protecting those who want to exit a tenancy.
No, thank you, John. And I think it is important. I'm doing a lot of work on domestic abuse, and especially when the perpetrator leaves and that victim is left with either children, and your right control comes into question there. So I think that's something certainly I'd like to see more of, to see that how we can help those victims as well.
Pam, and I'm going to.
But I think just more broadly, away from domestic abuse, as we understand it, the end in the joint tenancy, the new proposals would provide a 3-month window, which is the same as the landlord notice. So I suppose it's whether the parties can assign another tenant or it then ends for all. So at least there is some parity between the 3 months and the scenarios, if that makes sense. Probably the main impact would be on the rent and the rent review, if it's where the new one tenancy ends and a new tenancy starts. I think that's some of our trying to work that out.
Okay. You're right there that a balance has to be struck, but what's important is 3 months sometimes isn't enough for those victims, because I certainly know that, you know, the court delays and everything else in the system. By the time something comes back from any legal areas, that it could take more than 3 months. So it's just having that fine balance that we don't have the landlords out of pocket, but also we do consider those domestic abuse victims as well.
But I think if that can, you know, unintended consequences can be ironed out and built into the bill, then that would be welcome.
Okay. Thanks very much for getting the detail on that important question. I'm now going to bring in Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. Firstly, I would draw attention to my declaration of interest, which indicated I was a registered landlord until April this year. Probably the first question really for John Blackwood. The Bill's provisions give tenants greater rights to personalise their home. What might the benefits be to tenants and landlords having that right?
I think that the policy intention of the Bill is very much about encouraging tenants to feel that it is their home, which of course it is, and that they can create local connections and develop a family within that particular property. And part of that could well be adding your own touches to it, personalising the property, and of course having pets. And I think most of us as landlords would support that. We want tenants to feel that it is their home and potentially to be living in our properties for long periods of time. And that's absolutely fine. I think that's in everybody's interest. Where our members have concerns here is effectively what happens when this goes wrong. So that all sounds fine, and I think most people would sign up to that. But what happens when that tenant leaves the property and damage has resulted as a result of them having a pet or decorating in a way that's just not acceptable for future tenants, where you have to go in and rectify the situation? So I think what we really would like to see more from the Bill is more reassurance to landlords as to what would happen when things go wrong. So what mitigations could be put in place there to put the property back in the condition it was before the tenants moved into that property. So that could be greater deposits being charged, the facility for that. So there's more reassurance from the landlord's perspective that there is money there in case that there has to be remedial works carried out, or indeed insurance-backed products as well too. In some other parts of the world, in America for instance, when pet ownership in the private rental sector is very common, but it's a requirement that you have an insurance policy in place, and that seems to be accepted and is the norm within the sector. So I think we could move towards that, but landlords need to be reassured that there is enough mitigations in place to support them in the event of situations where it goes wrong and damage has resulted in the property.
I understand that there's reference to minor structural changes. What does that imply?
Well, we don't know. That's part of the issue that we're talking to the government about at the moment. The government's very keen to stress that actually this is good practice in the sector as it is at the moment, and they just want to bring into legislation which probably already exists. I've already mentioned, as a landlord myself, I have tenants with pets in the property, and that works pretty well. I don't have issues with that, but I've got good long-term sustainable relationships with those tenants, and they've invested in it as their home. So that could mean they're allowed to put up a picture or a poster, or is that a shelf? You know, what are these alterations? And of course, some of them could involve more remedial works being carried out at the end of the tenancy than others, which might require a higher deposit to be taken or some sort of insurance product.
Anna, I think you were keen to come in there.
Yeah, I think the two key points here. I think definition and guidance is going to be absolutely critical, just to try and keep things on an even keel, to avoid things going wrong where they needn't have gone wrong in the first place. But from what John was saying there about deposits, I think what has to be taken into consideration here is a deposit cannot be greater than 2 months' rent. Now, if you've got a lovely flat in the new town of Edinburgh that you let out, 2 months' rent is going to be pretty peachy. But if you have got a cottage in Dumfries and Galloway that rents out for £450 a month, your deposit's a whole lot smaller. Are your costs any less? Could the costs of repair be more commonly greater? You know, there's a lot more that goes into it than just actually the deposit's fine, we'll just increase that by 10%, because it depends on what the base rent is in the first place. So deposit is okay, but regional variances, rental variances are going to have to be taken into account. So whether the insurance thing is actually a better option. And I'll just give you one example just to show what can go wrong is in the Lothians, lady had gone round to see her tenant who had acquired four dogs, but not only four dogs when they were permitted to have one, they had also started housing them in the adjacent steading that they didn't actually have any rights to use, and they were having issues not only asking her to reduce the number of dogs down to the one dog that was permitted, but also to remove them from the steading. But then what's the lesser of two evils, having four dogs in the house or four dogs in a piece of property that they don't actually have a tenancy over? So that's just an example of how things can go wrong if the barriers are not finally...
You've mentioned previously about the differences in rural properties versus urban properties. Is there a different pattern in rural properties in terms of what tenants already do, in terms of redecoration?
I would say so because tenancies tend to be longer. Also, there's typically a relationship between landlord and tenant. I'm not saying that doesn't happen in urban areas, but it's the norm in rural areas. Because the proximity of where people are living, they're typically living in the same community, kids are going to the same school and everything. So it's easy to have that conversation. Do you mind if I paint little Joe's bedroom pink, whatever? Those conversations happen much more easily because people are seeing each other the whole time. Pets, it's a pretty normal thing. One of our members is wringing her hands at the moment because one of her tenants has heard that they're allowed to have pets now. This is just the communication from all the chatter out there about this bill. And she's saying, well, you can't because your front door opens onto a field that is not enclosed and there are sheep in that field. So you can't have a dog. And that's why it says in the lease that this is a dog-free property. So all these little things need to be just covered off to make sure that tenants understand where it's logical, where it's not logical, what is responsible and what is reasonable. And I think it's the definition of reasonable.
Timothy.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Speaker, for the question. I think from a letting agent point of view, in the conversations we've had with members and their landlords, the positive is that often, where tenants make the changes or make a property more their own, they tend to stay longer than those who do not. So that's, I think, the main positive. But the caveat is that I think, agents, landlords, consent to it on a sort of pragmatic basis at the moment, and often granted on the basis that the property is returned to its original condition at the start of the tenancy, should there be changes. So it's all about reducing or mitigating a risk. That could be a perceived risk or an actual risk from landlords, and it's ultimately those costs to remarket. In relation to the bill, I think your question of what should it include, well, we don't know. As John's alluded to, under the Category 1, Category 2, there's nothing listed. Category 1, I think probably pictures and posters. Category 2, we're working on shelves and things like that, but we don't know. So that needs to be consulted on pretty quickly. But I think in terms of the legislation and the conditions of consent, which is the wording in the bill, I think that needs to include returning the property to its original condition at the start of the tenancy. And if that's already taken as given by the legislators, then fine. But I think that's the perceived risk that needs to be reduced, and what we hear back from letting agent members.
Thank you. I don't propose to ask every witness, but if anybody has a wish to have input on this particular point.
Yeah, so Colin Robin has indicated that he wanted to come in.
Okay, Robin.
Thank you. I just want to make a brief point that in build-to-rent communities, and typically in urban apartment build-to-rent communities, most operators have a positive pet policy, and that's because they recognise that people with pets are likely to stay longer. They also have, in some of their social events, they might have dog-meet-dog events and the like, and that all... It helps build community, and it helps also people stay longer. And from an investor perspective, that's a positive. There needs to be a balance, and I think people have made the point that there needs to be a test of reasonableness. Because in those same communities, you might have people with allergies to pets, or you might have people with phobias. So you need to be respectful of other people in multi-occupancy buildings. So yes, by all means, have them, but have some thought for others And also some thought for the type of pets. You know, smaller pets that might be able to escape might be an issue. So that it's about the tests of reasonableness and balance. But I think overall the proposals are supported.
Thank you. Let me just move on to another issue, which again I'll come back to you, John Blackwood. The bill provides that unclaimed tenancy deposits can be used by ministers to support private sector tenants. What's your views on that?
Well, the money essentially has been provided by tenants, and I think, you know, I can understand the reasoning that it should be used to support them. However, I think it would be more appropriate that the money is used to be invested in housing for those in need. So could there be another route to be able to invest that money in much-needed housing in the future, or providing deposits for those who can't afford deposits? So we have a number of charities operating throughout Scotland that do exactly that. So for tenants that can't afford to provide a deposit, they will support them by providing the deposit. So could we use the money for that? So to prevent homelessness and support tenants on low incomes, I think that would be a far better use of the money.
Given the nature of this, do you have any feel, I mean, this may have come out in previous sessions, and obviously I'm just sitting in this one, but what is the sort of figure we're talking about for unclaimed tenancy deposits? Do you have any knowledge of that?
Again, noting an interest, I happen to be a director of the largest tenancy deposit scheme in Scotland, Safe Deposit Scotland. So, and I know that there are national statistics available. I don't have them to hand at the moment, but I'm very happy to share that information with you after today's session.
That would certainly be interesting. And again, coming to Anna, obviously there's a difference in the urban story here in terms of unclaimed deposits. Is there much of this in the rural sector?
I think in terms of the unclaimed deposit, I think it's less of an issue because you've got a lower amount of students, and I think that the students, the international students particularly, are a big driver of the unclaimed deposits because perhaps lack of information, they don't know that they can claim their deposit or and things like that. So without drilling down into the data, it's difficult to know exactly how much of it is attributable to rural. But because of the typically tenants staying for longer and things like that, it's probably less proportion. However, the needs of tenants in terms of the suggestions that John's just made are just as great. And I'm sure that they would all be delighted to benefit from a pot if there was one.
Yes, Timothy.
I think I'd agree with both what Anna and John has said in terms of using the money to sustain tenancies. I think anecdotally, I don't think there's a huge amount of money, and I think it's actually been diminishing. I think what's key for our members is the kind of reporting back from the Scottish Government and ministers in terms of where that money's being spent and how it's being used. You know, I think certainly annual reporting, it may be 3 years, I think, in the bill it's put down. But also, I think on a practical level, as Anna has alluded to, the deposit certificates will need to be amended with all the relevant information and ensure that there's a lead tenant and lead contact. I'm sure many agents, after 5 years, it'd be difficult chasing everyone should claims start coming in. So, yeah, there's some practicalities around it, but I think on the whole, it's a relatively positive move.
Again, I'll ask if anyone else wants to come in this particular point.
Yep. I don't have anything to add other than what's already been said, so I'll keep that short.
Thanks very much, Colin. That brings us to the end of our questions. So I really appreciate you coming in. We have run over a bit of time, but I think that was really important to hear all your points. If there's anything else you feel that we haven't had time to cover, feel free to write to the committee on those points. So thanks again for coming in and sharing your perspective. I'm now going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. I now welcome our second panel of witnesses to the meeting. We're joined in the room by Lisa Mallon, who's the housing manager at the City of Edinburgh Council, Derek McGowan, who's the Service Director for Housing and Homelessness at the City of Edinburgh Council, and Jennifer Seddon, who's the Head of Housing at Glasgow City Council. And we're joined online by Kelly Ferns, who is the Research and Development Officer at Argyll and Bute Council, and Ali McLeod, who's the Head of Housing and Building Standards at Aberdeenshire Council. And we're now going to turn to questions. We're going to try to direct them as much as possible to a specific witness initially, but if you'd like to come in, please indicate really clearly to myself or the clerks. And if you're online, do that by typing an R in the chat function. Also, there's no need for you to operate your microphones. We'll do that for you. So I'm going to begin with the topic of rent, and I'd be interested to hear what your views are. And I think this one maybe is for everybody. Well, I would say that's for everyone if you've got something new and different to add to what somebody else has said. So this is around the rent control area provisions in the bill and how that might have an impact on councils. And do you think, so what's your view on that? And also, do you think it will lead to rent stabilisation in any areas where rent controls would be introduced? And maybe I'll start with Jennifer.
So we are very supportive of the principles of the bill in terms of protecting tenants within the private rented sector. And Glasgow has seen a considerable increase in rents over the last period. And we are seeing that through several different teams that are working with private rented sector families. We are, I think, pretty much concerned about the level of rents within the city. However, we are also concerned about the unintended consequences of the legislation in terms of rent control. So I think the kind of key thing that we are concerned about is in terms of the kind of strategic impact of the rent controls on the city's housing system. And in terms of the supply of housing as well.
Okay, thanks for that. Anybody else want to come in on the kind of your view on the rent control area provisions and whether you think it will lead to rent stabilisation in the areas where the controls are in place? Derek?
Happy to, and thanks for the question. Similar to Jennifer's point, I think in Edinburgh we are supportive of the principles of the bill, in terms of tenants' rights and what the aims of the rent control provisions are. We have, probably, I think, the highest rent, average rent in the country, in Edinburgh. So a two-bed property is around about £1,500, which is £400 higher than the national average. So we know there's a particular issue here. And the provisions in the bill set out obvious ways to try and achieve that, which are welcome, but like Jennifer expressed, I think we have some concerns about unintended consequences. We've set them out in our response. We have an acute local issue. You'll know we have a housing emergency declared, and that's with over 5,000 homeless households in the city. So we are concerned that the rent control provisions may potentially work against that, and with a compounding effect of other measures that are in the bill that we may come to, then may increase homelessness, may add pressure on the market. So there's a stabilisation of rent that's possible. I think from the earlier witnesses, we heard the importance of data and understanding an accurate representation of what the rent setting levels are across the city. We'd welcome that very much, in order to try and understand how this bill might work and how that would affect the market in the city. Thanks.
Okay, I'm just going to go a little bit deeper there with the question. So the provision is that councils are going to be gathering data and identifying an area where they may want to propose a rent control area, and then that's going to be brought to ministers. I'd be interested to understand how, you know, that work might impact on councils.
Lisa.
Yeah, happy to speak on that, and thanks for the question. I think for us as well, just to give a bit of local context, we have about 43,000 landlords in the city, so we have very diverse, quite a large, you know, a lot small portfolios, quite diverse portfolios as well, and we estimate, you know, to have about 60,000 private rented properties in the city. So just the scale of collection is quite substantial. I think looking at the bill, obviously, and there's estimates around costs. I think in Edinburgh alone, we could probably absorb the majority of that budget, never mind nationally what we've estimated for the collection of. And I think that is absolutely critical, is to understand, I think, again, what was mentioned in the first session, there's a difference between advertised rents, starting rents, and actually what rents are, you know, at any given time. So I think for us, it's just the diversity and scale of what we'd be talking about in the city is quite substantial.
Okay, so you would be seeking to be properly resourced in order to carry forward that work. I see nodding heads across the panel. Anybody else online want to come in around that question on the impact of rent control area provisions in the bill on councils? Maybe I'll go to Argyll and Bute Council. Who's that? Kelly.
Thanks. I don't have much to add other than the panel members have already said. I think something for the concern for Argyll and Bute is the diverse geography that we have. We have a mix of urban, rural and island areas. And obviously any rent control proposed, I think we'd need to take into account of the area, within our own local authority, which is very diverse. And I think we, again, within our response, we've set out that we think there could be a lot of unintended consequences with applying a rent control. I think in terms of data collection, we need a really robust system to collect that both at a national level, but also to drill down to a local level to take into account, you know, the geography of the area, the types of the properties, infrastructure constraints, all the additional challenges and costs that tenants might occur, and the reason why the rents have to be controlled.
Okay. Some of you have started to get into my second question around unintended consequences around rent control. I'm going to stick with you, Kelly, and see if you can outline, as we've kind of heard from Edinburgh, could you outline the current state of the private rental market in Argyll and Bute, and then what you might anticipate happening as a result of the legislation?
Thank you, Convener. We have a shrinking private rented sector market, which has given us cause for concern as the first local authority to declare a housing emergency. It is putting a lot of pressures on our social housing system and also our homelessness. Over the last year, we've seen a reduction of approximately 20% in registered landlords. We have concluded, or just concluded in conjunction with Citizens Advice Bureau and Glasgow University, some research into our private rented sector. And whilst we don't have the final report, we've got some early insights into that. The response rate was about 8% from our landlords. But from that, 60% of them intend to sell their properties, which, again, given the shrinkage that we've had over the last year, is a huge concern for us. And something else that landlords have reported, which, again, we think could be an unintended consequence of rent control, is the yield they're getting at the moment is not particularly high in a lot of the areas. And I think at the previous session that was, you know, alluded to as well, you know, rents in rural areas can be a lot lower because they've got longer-term tenants who've been potentially there for decades, not just a few years. And out of the research we've just, has been concluded, 48% of old landlords only had a 4% or less net yield on their current rent levels. So you can see there's not a profit margin, it's not for profit.
Okay. Thanks for that. When you did the survey with the 8% response, with 60% of that 8% saying that they intend to sell, did you gather the reasons why they did, in your survey, did you get the detail as to why they intended to sell?
Yeah, we have asked some supporting questions around that, and unfortunately I don't have the full report. A lot of them were due to the challenges which were reported, and a lot of them was availability of trades to undertake improvement works required around housing quality standards and forthcoming standards. property maintainability for the same reason, the age of stock, being able to retrofit to meet standards. And actually one of the main challenges reported was the legislative burden that the field already imposed on landlords. And that included landlord registration, introduction of the PRT, and also for EPCs. And there was some initial feedback from, as I say, just the initial findings that have been shared with us, that the changes to energy efficiency standards is going to put real financial pressures onto landlords.
Okay, thanks very much.
Another reason for leaving.
Great, thanks very much for that detail. I'm just going to kind of come back and bring Ali in. And Ali, if you could pick up around the, if you've got anything new to add around the perspective from Aberdeenshire Council on the rent control provision in the bill and how that might impact on Aberdeenshire Council, but then also unintended consequences of rent control and your perspective on that.
Good morning, Convener, and thank you for pulling me in. Aberdeenshire's experience is quite different than what we've heard insofar as over the last decades, prices in the private rented sector have virtually come down quite significantly and stabilised in recent years. So any rent control measure would really not be required at the moment because the market has largely corrected itself. However, I think going forwards, there is value in us having the ability to explore that as a tool because, as Kelly has picked up around the mixture of local housing systems in rural areas, there is a quite a complex mix of interactions there between different tenures, and therefore there may be a value in from a strategic housing perspective and having that ability to determine that going forwards. But I would just echo similar comments around about the costs of resourcing that. So anything that we do needs to be done well and needs to be judicially robust as well. So we just need to think about that as it comes forward.
Okay, thanks very much for that. And I just, Jennifer, I didn't ask the question to you about the unintended consequences of rent control, such as decreases on supply in Glasgow. Can you outline the current state and what you think the legislation might impact?
Yeah, so currently Glasgow has about 60,000 private rented properties, about 40,000 private landlords. We haven't seen a reduction in the number of landlords within the system, even although anecdotally people are saying they're selling. I think for a variety of reasons, to be honest, not just the potential of rent controls, but I think anecdotally we're hearing that people who had invested in properties for their pensions are now cashing out, in effect, the complexity within the private rented system in terms of mortgages are also in tax, are impacting too. Most of our landlords, similarly to Edinburgh, only have one property. So 78% only have one property. And in terms of an actual kind of large portfolio of properties, you're talking about under 1%. So I suppose in terms of the resource requirements for councils to actually collect that information, I would absolutely endorse the need for having that local input, but also to have a national system of collection. Our experience of private landlord registration and enforcement required around that indicates that there's potentially about 5% of landlords who won't comply and that there'll be significant enforcement action required, which obviously has resource implications for the local authority. I don't think there's any reason to suggest that this would be particularly different, particularly if it's annual updating in terms of rental levels. I would also say that about half of the properties in Glasgow are also landlords use a letting agent to rent them out. So I think that's potentially a mechanism to help ensure compliance. I think that's all from me.
Great, that's very helpful. Thanks very much for that. I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol with a bit of a focus on rural.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Just want to touch a little bit more on what Kelly spoke about in the rural areas, that we've heard from the previous panel that the housing bill does not sufficiently address the needs for rural areas. So do you believe that the bill properly balances the needs for urban rural areas, and it may be this question is to Ali as well, but also asked a question earlier on, you probably may have heard it, around depopulation, and I certainly know, Kelly and Ali, I spoke to your CEOs, and that was an area that was a problem with depopulation in your areas. So do you think the provision of this bill with rent control also affects depopulation, since you guys have basically been working on this in the council and you know about your population growth? And also, how does it affect businesses as well, business growth?
Thanks, I can come in there. Absolutely. I think the impact on in rural areas, given the housing emergency and the severe lack of affordable housing options, is having a massive impact on the depopulation and trying to sustain and retain people within those rural localities. I think that's also true for businesses who are really struggling to get affordable worker accommodation. And again, that's more about sustainability of their existing business, but also it's containing any business growth within those areas. And I know our colleagues in High do a lot of engagement, particularly with our rural, you know, businesses and employers, and there is an aspiration to grow, but the lack of affordable housing options is constraining that, and that's across all our 9 housing market areas, not just in our rural localities, it's also having an impact on our urban areas as well.
Ali?
A similar position, really. I think rent control as a potential option in the future could have a quite a neutral impact from our view. I know Scottish Land and Estates have raised some concerns in terms of their rural landlords, and this could have a negative impact. But I think it's a wider issue than just what's contained in within this bill around depopulation. And there's wider, you know, pressures on the housing stock, and it's not just about rent levels around that. There's obviously the need for new supply, but there's also transfer of landed properties into other tenures or other types of use. So I think these are probably issues that are potentially more impactful than rent control from my perspective.
Thank you. Can I just go back to my first question? The bit was about, do you think the bill properly balances the needs for urban and rural areas?
I think from our perspective, it's fairly neutral. It doesn't really have a significant focus on rural areas. It is primarily an issue that has been materialised more recently in central urban areas. So from our perspective, it doesn't have a huge impact in terms of the actual provisions.
What about you? Sorry, Kelly, what about yourself?
Thanks. I think, again, in terms of rural and urban, it's quite neutral, the proposals in the bill. I don't think it'd have an adverse effect on our rural areas. I think if we were to consider doing rent controls, that would be something that we'd need a really good data collection on and the impact. And I think in the earlier session, some of those issues were raised about, you know, the size of the property. Is it a croft? Does it come with a huge amount of ground? You know, is there a difference between that two-bedroom rent and the neighbouring property's two-bedroom rent? There could be real good reasons for the fluctuation in rent levels. So if you were to apply a rent control, you would need a lot more data around the reasons for that rent being charged. I think for myself, the data collection is crucial for this, and particularly in rural areas, where it might be quite hard to get that information. And some of these longer standing tenancies and potentially some tenancies that haven't moved to the PRT system as well, where you've still got, you know, insured tenancies in the background where people's rights have been protected. I think there was a good point raised by Anna in the previous session about, you know, even in terms of the rural and the functionality of those properties, sometimes that can be part of a business, not just somebody's property, you know, if it's neighbouring farm, crofting, these different things. So I think the bill itself, I don't think really defined the rural and urban differences between the measures, and I think it would be reasonably neutral.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey with what seems to be the hot topic of the day, data.
The hot topic, data collection. Good morning, everybody. I just wanted to ask our council colleagues about the power to set rent controls. It's entirely at the council's discretion whether to recommend
that to Scottish ministers, whether to apply a rent control area within your council area. What are your concerns then if you have that discretion to not do that if you decide it's not appropriate? Because you won't do it, will you?
Thanks for the question. I think it's a question of data quality. It's the range of data that's held across all different aspects of a tenancy, duration, how long that tenancy is, how often the rent has been increased in that tenancy. So having some sort of system, they say on an annual basis it's flat or it's increasing, so you can understand some of the wider pressures in the area. Data quality is the fundamental. If you don't put good data in, you won't get good data out. And if the data that's going isn't complete, you won't get that either. So in Edinburgh, we would want to know, if I'm thinking ahead, we would want to know what it was at a city level, what the average was. But in particular areas of the city where there are more pressures than others, then what is the average level there? How often has it changed? How often has it increased? Is it individual landlords taking an opportunity to increase because the legislation allows them to, or are they not doing that because they've got settled tenancies for a period of time? There's probably much more there, but the fundamental is good quality data going into the system in order to get valuable and robust data out. I think the legislation requires us to make that assessment, and if we feel there's a need to put anything to ministers then to do that, but there's got to be certainty in that, or what we put to ministers in order for a decision to be made or for agreement in that case isn't going to be robust.
My point really is that ultimately it's your council leadership that will decide whether to request a rent control zone or not, and that decision will be based on whether you've got data and evidence to back it up. So my point really is that you still retain the control and the power and the discretion as to whether to do this or not. It's a flexible application of that power in that sense. So you need the data to back it up, but ultimately your council leadership could decide not to make any such recommendations to ministers if you're not content that you have sufficient data locally to justify it. That's the case, isn't it?
Yeah.
That is absolutely the case. I mean, I think the issue about the different geographies will be an interesting one in terms of at what level people might consider a rent control area. You know, is it a street? Is it a political ward? Is it the whole city? You know, whether you have particular priorities for different areas of your city. We've got the transformation regeneration areas within Glasgow. We also have a very much of a focus on city centre regeneration at the minute. Obviously, you've heard about the kind of impact on build-to-rent investment within that. So I think all these things are considerations, and I think in some ways there's competing priorities there, you know, around, you know, protecting tenants, but also the strategic priorities for the city and what you want to deliver. At Glasgow, we have got a build-to-rent development happening just now for family housing. That family housing is absolutely a priority for us, but currently there'll be no more of that until there's certainty. And I think that's what we absolutely need out of this, is some certainty and not pushing things back, because as soon as the investment community have certainty, then we can get on with getting some investment done. But I think the geography aspect will be a very interesting one, whether it's citywide, whether it's a local level, and whether it takes cognizance of some of these strategic priorities within the areas.
So, getting straight back to the data issue, though, I think what you're saying is the data set that ultimately is gathered has to be really robust and wide and localised and all of the rest of that. If that does provide you guys, as officials of the councils, to make such a recommendation to your council leadership, is that what you're seeking? That there's a broader discussion about what is in the data that can allow us to make such a recommendation. So what would that data look like in the widest sense? Lisa, your hand up, maybe you could offer a...
Yeah, absolutely. Happy to be. Yeah, and I think quite a lot of it was covered in the first session as well. But just to say, I've been involved in quite a lot of working groups around the rent pressure zone piece, and also, and quite a few of us have. So we've shared quite a lot of detailed information, what we would seek to find. I think just to your previous point as well, although it is a localised decision, we'd still need that information, so we still need to resource up to get that data. So we were presenting the data that we currently had. I think, as Derek touched on, needs to be robust so that we're not challenged, that we're clear that we've got that consistent view that we can then, if we choose to hone in a hotspot or we choose to set it at a citywide. So we need that information, and that comes with resourcing and making sure that we've got the systems in place even to collect and analyse that data. But I think we need, we just need data across the board, and in getting that, and I think it should be nationalised. I think there is something in that. It's something that we've suggested throughout the working group, so that is something that we do believe that should be a nationalised system, and therefore, and then through that, we at least have the consistency, the baseline consistency, in which we can then seek to move forward and apply that.
There was discussion about whether we should have a national approach to collection of data, definition collection of data probably, but how on earth did that work for, say, Edinburgh and Glasgow compared to, say, the Borders or the Western Isles or something? You need some kind of element of local flexibility that drives that data, surely. How do we get that balance? Derek?
Yeah, I just come back in. I think in terms of data sets, then postcode area, where the rent is paid, the size of the property, the local context. I think that's raw data that can go in at a local level. Postcode, street level, as Jennifer said, there has to be the availability to interpret the data and interrogate it to that level. And that, I think that would make it an equal system across the country. Then at a local level, you're applying a local context. So areas, you look at indices of multiple deprivation. What does that data mean in terms of poverty in the area or affluence in the area? What does it mean? And having a historical level of data means you can do a bit of historical analysis and understand so if you take postcode level as an example, then what has changed over the last 3-5 years in that. So having that level of data and that detail would help the local analysis. And then we can put our own page over it. So, like I said, poverty, income, employability, etc., and make a more nuanced argument there as to whether it should be introduced. I think an important thing here, as Lisa said, in order to do that, in reference to your earlier question, so we would, if we wanted to, as officers, we thought what a rent control should be introduced, we would have to go to our council committee to council in order to get that decision. That data has to be gathered regardless, even if the committee says, no, we don't think that's appropriate, we don't want to go ahead with that. Following on from that, the ministers receive the report, but then there's a duty to consult. So if we have incorrect data that isn't robust and it can't be analysed properly, as soon as the ministers go back to consult, the people, the landlords and the tenants in that area will say, well, that data isn't accurate. And it prolongs the whole process and the legislation's been introduced to achieve something. Without the robust data going in, it would just elongate the process to a point where none of us would want to be.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for that. That's really helpful in response to that, because it's a big issue about what data sets should look like and how relevant it should be and so on and so forth. And I'm sure there'll be other questions as the committee business proceeds. But thank you.
Thanks, Willie. I know it was said that it was said in the previous session, but I would really actually appreciate hearing from yourselves as to what you think the list should be. So maybe we could just create that together now. So maybe Lisa, you were nodding enthusiastically there, so I put you on the spot.
It was just appreciating. Yeah, we're sort of nodding back to the previous session. Is it just around the type of data? Would you like a bit more
kinds of things that councils would want to have?
Absolutely. So I think, Derek's covered quite a few of them. Just even bedroom size, starting rents, advertised rents, actual rents. All we see is obviously what's advertised. Who's to say if there's been a separate agreement made with the tenant that goes into the property? Obviously, for us as well, we've got HMOs in the city, lots of different types of rentals too, similar to what Jennifer touched on too, lots of different landlords. So I suppose baseline data is just information that we would have on in our social sector, just even to map that across, so that we could understand where that is. I think also it's interesting, Kelly, just that understanding of where landlords are at. That's maybe a more personalised view of their intention to stay in the sector, reasons for being in the sector, just understanding a bit more why they're there, if they've only got one property or what they're seeking to do and expand there too. So I think there's even a bit more of that that would be helpful as we would move forward to analyse and understand the growth or change in the sector.
Okay, thanks. And when we talk about data sets and national or local, is there a place that exists already in our kind of system that we could put those data sets, or would we have to create something new? Jennifer?
Obviously, the private landlord registration database sits there currently. You know, it's got every registered property on it. It seems like the sensible place to ask for that information. Obviously, landlords only have to register every 3 years, and we would probably be looking for updates in between those times annually, probably. I think one of the issues is about the quality of accommodation as well, and we find this in, and that's a much harder, I think, nut to crack, if you like, you know, how that would be reflected in an area, because obviously one bedroom property might be a luxury one, and one may be very basic, although it meets all the standards. I'm not offering a suggestion as to how you do that. However, I think it does get complex. But the private landlord database is certainly there. It is nationwide. It seems to be the most obvious.
Okay, yeah, certainly quality is something that the committee is interested in. Also, in the previous session, Robin Blacklock, he mentioned this idea of rent per square foot. What do you think about that idea?
I think that that could work. I'm not sure if that's maybe making it a wee bit more complicated for individuals to report on. Again, it doesn't really get away from the, it doesn't really answer the quality aspect of it either. I'd have to have a think about that one and how that was actually done.
Derek, you seem to be interested in that.
Yeah, I think that may be more for an investment purpose in terms of Robin's input. I mean, it might be a misrepresenting him, but in terms of investing in the market, I think if you are looking to rent a property as a private individual, what's of interest to you is location. It's going to be number of bedrooms. You know, on viewing the property, the quality of it is going to be relevant. So I think that square footage cost is more likely to be for investing in the first place.
All right. Thanks very much. Kelly or Ali, do you have anything to add to our list of data sets that we would be wanting to have a look at? Kelly and then Ali.
Yeah. Thanks, convener. I agree. I think the landlord register would be a good baseline place to start, but I think the guidance around landlord registration in the system would need to be strengthened quite substantially to take into kind of wider aspects that we've discussed. So in terms of data we would need to collect through just landlord registration, I feel like rently, obviously the current rent at the start of the tenancy, the annual uplift, which we need to get on an annual basis, the size of the property, but the type of the property would be a flat, semi-detached, detached property. The grounds, in terms of not just garden grounds, but if it was croft, any outbuildings and things should be reflected on that. Parking, the age of the building, and the housing quality standard and energy efficiency standard, EPC rating. I think that's something that could be standardised as a question through landlord registration. But I think in terms of doing it nationally, there's a couple of reasons why we would support that. We could then do a bit of benchmarking between local authorities and compare those rural, urban, island areas. So locally, you could then apply things like the urban classification to that postcode area to now a lot more local analysis. We could look at income levels at that local area. We could look at the local housing allowance rates at that local area. And I think we would need that national data, but also that local data to inform any decision. As you say, if we were to put that to members to propose a rent control zone, you would need to have real strong evidence behind that. And just one other point, which might not be particularly relevant to this, but I think just when the discussions progress, it's made me think about it. We're also looking at legislation out with the Housing Scotland Bill about short-term let control zones. And I have a concern that if we control one area, the tenure might just flip to another area, and it's how we get those to work in tandem together within those areas, because we might just push you know, if we apply a rent control area and we don't have a short-term let control area in that, we could just be flipping 10 years so they can get a higher yield back from doing a short-term let rather than a private rented property.
Okay, thanks. Ali, do you have anything to add in this area?
Just briefly, I would echo the same position around about nationalisation of the data collection as much as possible, help standardise that and reduce some of the costs of doing it 32 times. And just picking up on Kelly's point around about energy efficiency, I think that would be a really useful measure potentially for rural areas because it helps us to understand some of the challenges that private tenants are facing, but also thinking about the future requirements for landlords in rural areas around about energy efficiency. And that is, you know, an area looking ahead that could be a big challenge going ahead.
Okay, great. Thanks very much. Now going to move on and bring in Gordon MacDonald.
Okay, thanks very much, convener, and good morning, panel. since we're talking about the private landlord register and how to improve it, when you sell a property, you have to produce a home report. Should there be something similar in place for landlords when they go to rent a property out? We've talked about the data sets that would need to be collected, and obviously what people are concerned about predominantly is the level of rent and the quality of the accommodation. So is there a need for something like that to gather the information? Maybe Jennifer first.
I think that would be an excellent idea. We come up against a lot of very good quality private rented housing in Glasgow, but we come up against some really, really poor quality housing as well. And I think it fits quite well with the kind of improved information that tenants are meant to get when they move into a property. To be honest, I mean, I think that's a very good suggestion. I think, again, it's around the enforcement part of that and how you ensure that has been provided in the correct way and at the correct time. But I think that I would certainly support that.
I'm going to come on to enforcement in a minute. Derek, can you?
I think it's a good idea. Certainly locally, we receive complaints about the condition of private rented properties, and occasionally that can lead to people presenting as homeless in terms of in the conditions they're living in. I think in principle, that's a suggestion that would support.
Okay. Kelly or Ali, do you want to add anything? No.
I think the only thing I would add to that is the current sort of landlord registration system has been set up to say that the landlord's fit for purpose, but it doesn't capture enough around housing quality standards. I think that's a really good recommendation to capture something around the quality of the property that's been rented.
Okay, thanks very much. So as I said, I was going to go on to enforcement. We heard evidence last week that many people, I think there was a survey done by the Rent Better Research, you said that many people didn't know what their rights were, despite the fact they've got a tenancy agreement. Some of them didn't even know what tenancy they were, type of tenancy they were on. So how do we improve the level of information for private tenants? Yeah?
Jennifer.
I think that nationally there's been good schemes in the past when there's been launches of new policies or the PRT or whatever. I think we don't nationally not very good at continuing that work, and obviously there's tenants that are coming into the system that have never been there before. So I think there's absolutely a role for having an ongoing scheme around that. At Glasgow we have an officer who deals directly with landlords in order to, I suppose, upskill them and create the knowledge around what they're required to do, and she provides a lot of support to those landlords. Obviously, there's only one of her and there's an awful lot of landlords, and a lot of landlords only have one property, so it's quite a job. We also have a team called the Private Rented Sector Welfare Hub, and they deal directly with families within the private rented sector who are at risk of homelessness. Right. It's quite a unique team, and they feedback that all the time. These are households who have left the private rented sector for a very long time, but they don't necessarily know their rights, and they also don't really have connections into a lot of the kind of welfare services, income support, and those kind of services as well. So I think as well as rights There's also something about private rent tenants not knowing actually what they're entitled to, and that we should be targeting that as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And maybe, I don't know, Derek, Lisa, if you want to comment, but, you know, part of the difficulty is that tenants, if they want to stay in a property, they want to build a good long-term relationship with the landlord, and they don't want the hassle or the time or the cost of complaining. But, I mean, how do you resolve that situation? How do you make tenants more aware of what their rights are and also support them to enforce those rights, given that, you know, there's that social interaction between them and the landlord?
Yeah, thanks. I think practically making sure that the correct information is provided at time of sign-up. So when you're signing the lease, standard information to be available. I think, like Jennifer, we have a team that works with any tenants, including private rented, in terms of security of tenure. So having standard availability of information, how that's publicised. So we have information on our website, but we know through research locally and nationally that there are still some barriers to access. So making that available in ways that's accessible to people, and that includes people with disabilities, it includes people, for example, when English isn't your first language, making it available, because we know there are issues in the private rented sector that we've experienced with that, and people not even knowing how to access their rights, let alone knowing what they might be. So there are issues there, and I think that can be included in barriers to advice. In terms of the relationship with the landlord, the kind of second point of your question there, there can be a fear, and that's what we know as well, there can be a fear of raising objections in case it ends up in eviction. And that's about robust enforcement of those standards, but also, I would say, and I can speak for Edinburgh, in terms of the advice that we give and the teams that we have to work with people, we know they're in difficulty, then ensuring that we can advocate for them if we need to, and take that advice forward. So probably a mix of options there, but I think there's a fundamental, if there's a standard that we want to achieve in the private rented sector, it's a national standard that's set out, and it's something that perhaps alongside the collection of data then that we're making, that here's standard, you must provide this.
How do you enforce the legislation at the moment? I mean, the councils have got a responsibility to make sure that somebody is a fit and proper person, that they're registered with the landlord registration system, that gas certifications are taking place, and EPC ratings are taking place. How do you go about enforcing that at the moment, and how many enforcement cases do you have in an average year?
I couldn't give you the cases. I can provide that separately to the committee the numbers. But we have a team of officers who will undertake inspections of properties. So if we get complaints, they will be undertaken, and on renewal of registration and licence, depending if it's HMO or if it's private rented, then they'll get a visit. We do that in conjunction with other public services, so police, fire, etc. So a pretty good system of inspecting the properties and making sure that all those issues are addressed, and then if the complaints come in, then obviously that's a follow-up, and occasionally there are complaints about unregistered landlords as well that will get followed up as well, and certainly in that respect working closely with the police. So there's a good system, I think, across the public sector, certainly in Edinburgh, in terms of doing that work and making sure it gets to the regulatory committee.
Okay. And Jennifer, you said that about 5% of your landlords don't comply.
Yeah,
so I mean, two parts. One, what does Glasgow do about it? And secondly, how do we make improvements to the enforcement regime?
So I think the private landlord registration system is still quite light touch. You know, I mean, it is very much self-certification to quite a degree. I do have some numbers here. So in terms of late application fees, so these are used for renewal and new registration. So what we do is we make two or more requests to the landlord, and then our procedure is to apply on the third if they don't reply to the third. So in terms of renewals, last year we applied the late application fee in 563 cases, and that was again for renewals that were 9,585. I think the thing that we find most helpful is the rent suspension orders, which we use as the most effective enforcement tool. So that means that landlords are letting properties when they're unregistered. So in effect, we take away the rent liability of the tenant. And last financial year, we applied 303 rent penalty notices. And this year, we've done a further 58. And my team tells me is that the rent penalty notices are around 90% effective in terms of dealing with non-registration. I think the kind of feedback from the teams are that we work really closely with landlords, and in general, once we start the process, landlords will comply. There's obviously that very small element that won't, and I think some of the issues are when, so for example, going to the Procurator Fiscal to take a case or whatever, some of the fines that have been applied across Scotland have been very low. I think it's a maximum of 50,000, but I think in general it's been a very, very low, and I suppose for us that's a kind of warning, if you like, around some of the compliance issues around the rent control and the and having to provide information around rental levels, the amount of effort that may have to go in from a local authority in order to ensure that landlords comply around providing that information.
Okay, thanks very much.
Gordon, actually, both Kelly and Ali have indicated they want to come in. So, Kelly.
Thanks, convener. I think in terms around enforcement, I think to apply that in terms of landlord registration, to some of the really good examples given there about how you can go through that process. I think that's within a local authority's gift to do that just now, because we've got a register, we know who hasn't submitted their renewal and who's due for renewal. But I think the biggest concern in the background would be the tenants that don't speak up. And that could be, again, it's been touched on earlier in the session, but, you know, just they're wanting to build up a rapport with a landlord. They've got a really good rapport with the landlord. They're related. There might be some other reasons why they don't. But ultimately, it could be the risk of losing that accommodation. There might not be anything alternative in that area, in that locality. And that's why the tenants won't speak up. I think, again, one of the key issues is a lack of resources within local authorities. We are all struggling for resource. And if there could be sort of dedicated and mandatory sort of post applied along with landlord registration, where we have to do random inspections and both the tenants and the landlords as part of their tenancy agreement agree to that, I think that could be a control that's applied in the background, where you randomly select a percentage of properties every year, so you're getting a feel for that. I know Edinburgh touched on they do visual inspections with HMOs, but I don't think it'll be standard practice across all 32 local authorities where they would go out and just look at any landlord registration just for an individual tenancy. So perhaps that's another way we could look at enforcement slightly different about doing some random inspections. And the other final point there is just that we're relying, again, it's been touched on in terms of landlords complying with landlord registration. Is it their discretion to be honest and say that they are private landlords and they're registered? But how many other private properties are out there being rented where they're not registered as a landlord? And how do we uncover those if the person's paying rent directly and they're not coming through any system? That's all. Thanks.
Thanks very much. And Ali?
Yeah, thank you. Three brief points. I think, first of all, at the point of registration, we do work well with Police Scotland and to ensure fit and proper. I think on the whole, secondly, that we do get a good response from our landlords where we are. Do have to explore any enforcement. So once we've determined the extent of any issue, we'll develop an action plan with the landlord and manage that proactively until the case is resolved. And so that deals with the majority, and there are some that we will need to make onward referrals to the Housing and Property Chamber. But on the whole, that process works fairly well. And just picking up on Kelly's point, we do spot checks. So about 10-15% of registrations, we do spot check, trying to get on, on the front foot around some of those cases where we potentially tenants might not be speaking up.
Okay. Yeah, thanks very much. Just on the spot checks, Ali, what flag or signal do you get to, how do you choose the spot check places?
I think we do it randomly, to be honest. So it allows us just to, there's no science in behind it, to be honest. I think it's just a random check. But that's been quite helpful. And if we do 10% annually, then we're soon working our way through the whole sector, really.
OK, thanks very much for that. Now going to bring in Colin Beattie with a question.
Thank you, Convener. Very simple question. The bill has provisions to give tenants greater rights to personalise their homes. What do you think about that? What are your views on it? Derek, maybe I can start with you.
Thanks. It's positive. We support the principle of the bill in that regard. So the benefits there for the tenant, the benefit for the landlord, I think, in terms of probably working maybe in a longer tenancy basis, because the tenant's happier, more comfortable, more settled. So can see benefits there. I've been a private tenant myself, so I understand the benefits of being able to do that. In principle, positive. I think as we set out in our response, that there's potentially some unintended consequences there in terms of the level of work that a private tenant can do to a property, how comfortable the landlord is with doing that, and perhaps in conjunction that compounding effect with other areas here, we think there might be an unintended effect in terms of how the landlord might feel about the overall of the bill. But in principle, yeah, tenants' rights are good and supportive of that.
Now, Edinburgh has a particular issue around the size of student accommodation. Yeah. Now, I'm not saying other councils don't have the same thing, but Edinburgh has a huge proportion. How do you think it's going to work in that respect, where there's a tendency for students to stay for only 9 months and then leave the premises?
Sorry, I thought Lisa was going to come in. There are a number of working groups in Edinburgh at the moment looking at student accommodation, so it's certainly a live issue, and I know nationally other cities are involved in that as well, so it's not just an Edinburgh issue. I think it has to be seen in conjunction with the Edinburgh market specifically. Obviously, you've talked about the 9 months that students might be there, but there's also issues related to availability accommodation and for the festivals, for example, and the restrictions that are proposed, I think, in the legislation, restrictions on how often rent can be raised, I think don't particularly change existing practice anyway. So there are limits on that, but I can see there's potential issues there in terms of students around affordability, when rents would be raised, and therefore the provisions in the legislation probably positive in that respect, because it would be an annual basis at the very most.
Jennifer, tenants' rights to personalise their home.
I'm very supportive of it. I think private rent particularly, I think in previous years we thought that, you know, it was a bit of a stopgap for folk, but now it's absolutely cemented as a housing option, one that people are choosing. Our experience as well of working to our teams with private rent is that there's an awful lot of people that are privately rented for a very long time and have been frustrated maybe by the fact that they can't do as much to their home to make it their own, although I understand that obviously a lot of private landlords do let them do that anyway. Absolutely supportive of it. As a non-stock owning authority as well.
Kelly, do you have an issue on that?
No, we are very supportive. I think one thing that, you know, I'm very mindful of, everybody has a right to a home, not just a property. And if they can personalise that and tailor that, they're more likely to take pride in their home, and that leads to sustainability and actually security for the landlord. But I think it has to be within reason, and there has to be clear guidelines, particularly around the pets. It could become uncontrollable. I think in the previous session, the example of the one dog multiplying to four dogs, that type of thing. So I think it has to be clear guidelines for the tenants and the landlords, but we are in support of the proposals.
Okay, thank you. Maybe just briefly, Ali.
Yeah, support, likewise, nothing to add.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Colin. Now going to move to questions from Mark Griffin around evictions, and Mark's joining us online.
Thanks, Convener. Yep, I have a few different questions around about evictions, and the first one
is the proposal within the bill to require the tribunals to consider whether to delay an eviction or not as standard with every application, and just wonder if witnesses support this change or not, and what are the reasons behind that.
Anybody want to pick that up? Derek?
Excuse me. Again, principle, yes, support that. I think an important element would be, though, that, and I would imagine national practice, I can speak on behalf of the council here in Edinburgh, but I think national practice would be anything that went to a first-tier tribunal or anything that would go to court in terms of recovery of the property would be an absolute last resort. So the amount of work that would go in to even get to that point is solely aimed at avoiding any sort of eviction. So we have, across our entire council, a number of different officers that would work with tenants of our properties, but with private rented tenants as well, in order to avoid that happening. So I think that's important. This, anything that goes near a court is a last resort, and the court would expect that, as would the first tier tribunal, they'd expect to see a number of steps had been taken. I think anything that can be done to secure the tenancy and secure the sustainability of the tenancy is good. But as we put in our response, I think there is an issue perhaps where I think the likelihood would be, if that duty is introduced, that the tribunal and the court will err on the side of that and provide that. I think it's a pretty straightforward analysis that anyone who's evicted from their property is going to, their well-being is going to be impacted. But as we heard in the previous session as well, that may then mean that the person who's in the property gets to build up a higher level of arrears than they already have, and that's not necessarily the best thing for them either. So I think there's a balance here. I think there's a good option here, but I think it is important to understand the level of work that goes in before anything gets near being lodged at a court.
Okay.
I'm sure you are hearing for the Housing Association. We've got 59 housing associations in Glasgow that we work with, and we have obviously lots of conversations with them, and I suppose they would just reflect, I think, what Derek's already said, that it's always a last resort. There are obviously implications, and I think it will just lengthen the period of time before somebody is actually asked to leave. So,
okay, thanks for that. Mark, do you want to move on to your next question? No one else has indicated they want to come in.
No problem, thank you. The next area I wanted to cover were charges for illegal eviction, and the bill changes the way that charges and damages are calculated, with the intention that it deters illegal eviction by being at risk of a much higher penalty. And just ask, this was a very brief answer in the last panel, whether you agree with that or not.
Lisa?
Yeah, I think just absolutely happy with that. I think it makes sense. Obviously, we want to limit the amount of illegal evictions at all costs. So, yeah, stricter penalties make sense in order to enable that. So, yeah.
Okay. Thanks. Anybody think differently on that one? Can't see. No. Okay. Mark, do you want to go on to your next question?
Yep. Thanks, Convener. Last question, maybe more substantive for local authority colleagues. Just ask, what is the link within your local authorities between evictions from private rented properties and homelessness in the area? And will the provisions around homelessness prevention potentially lead to better outcomes, fewer evictions and less pressure on your services?
Anybody want to take that? Derek?
I'll start. I don't have the figures in front of me, I'm afraid, but I can provide them. But there certainly is a number of presentations every year that we receive as from the private rented sector. I would say they're not always evictions. They are people leaving the private sector due to conditions as well, as we've mentioned earlier on. So there is a clear link there, but the scale of it, I would need to send, and I'm happy to send the details into the and to the convener. Certainly a clear link.
Okay, thanks. Kelly, you've indicated you want to come in.
Thanks, convener. I think in terms of the homelessness prevention, I think it'll have massive resource implications for local authorities initially, but ultimately the view there would be that longer term it's going to have a better outcome for tenants and those threatened with homelessness within that 6-month period. I had a wee look at some of our statistics in terms of homeless applications yesterday. And surprisingly, only 2% of our applications were due to termination of the tenancy or mortgage due to rent arrears. We found a higher presentation rate was other action by the landlord resulting in the termination of the tenancy, and that was 12% of our applications, which has been pretty static over the last 3 years. So I think there's definitely a direct link between the private renting sector and homelessness.
OK, Jennifer.
In terms of homelessness, but in terms of some of the anecdotal feedback that we're getting from the teams that are dealing with private rented tenants, I think one of the major shifts that we've seen in the last 6 months is that everybody who is coming into the service has a legal notice to leave, which is an absolutely enormous shift, as you like. And I think, again, although we are not seeing a reduction in the number of private rented properties, I think there is quite a lot of churn in terms of landlords selling and moving on, and that is obviously having a direct impact in terms of the tenants that are within those properties. And again, I think that is around mortgage rates changing, people cashing out their retirement nest eggs, and just the complexity around private renting at the minute. So I think there's maybe a job to do around some of that promoting how to be a private landlord and the kind of things we talked about previously.
Thanks very much for that. I'm going to move on. Mark, I think you've completed your questions, yeah? Yep, great. I'm going to move on and bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us here and online today. I wanted to ask if you had any comments with regards to the proposed changes to how joint private residential tenancies can be ended. And I think we've touched upon some of the issues where that has sometimes resulted in people being declared homeless, where that's not been facilitated. So just wondered how you would like to see that progress and if you have any issues or suggestions around that.
I'll go.
Kick off on that.
Yeah, thanks. I think it's welcome. Obviously, it can happen. It's something we see already. So providing more security to people in that position is important, I think. We know, I think, at the earlier session, it was certainly discussed around particular nuances there and perhaps domestic abuse and the issues it can have there. I think the legislation requiring a domestic abuse policy probably helps that in terms of setting out very clear guidance and how we would support people. Relationships break down, things can happen, and I think that there are risks around having to stay in a property just simply due to being tied to it. So anything that I think enables a discussion is important. We have to remember that where that happens, there might be one person left in a tenancy and that becomes unaffordable, and that perhaps leads to a homelessness position as well. So I think it's welcome in principle. I would probably want to see more detail on how that might be implemented and what it might mean in practice, because there's a lot of good practice going already, and there's a lot of people probably more knowledgeable than me in the impacts of these kind of social situations that would be good to see in maybe statutory guidance on it.
Anyone else have anything to add on that?
Nothing to add.
I wanted to also ask with regards to the rent controls, what we've seen today and the impact that's had on councils being able to put together sustainable tenancies, especially for people who are experiencing homelessness in the private rented sector, and what impact that has had on council colleagues being able to put together those tenancies. And whether or not that has been undermined or what your experience has been of that. I don't know if you have specific data on those pre and post the rent controls legislation, which you could provide us. If you can't today, then maybe beyond the meeting.
It'd be easier to provide, if that's okay,
sure.
And make sure we get proper data to you.
Okay, great. Thanks for that. And very briefly, I'm going to bring Willie Coffey back in with a question which I think is quite useful.
Thanks very much.
To understand.
It's an issue that bugged me for years as a local councillor, but could I ask you this question? If a landlord in your authority is deregistered because they have been deemed to be to meet the fit and proper test, to be a landlord, can they immediately hop to the other authority, one of, say, Glasgow and Edinburgh, just because you're there, and become a landlord there? Is there any impediment on them doing that if they fail the fit and proper test, say, in Edinburgh, and then appear in Glasgow and become a landlord?
We do liaise quite closely with our other local authority colleagues on that, but to get an absolute definitive answer, I would have to come back to you on that, I have to say.
I think fit and proper lies on police checks. So I think that Police Scotland having, you know, a single database on this and a different way of operating than they used to, certainly when I worked in licensing a few years ago, I think it's more likely that our offences and deregistration would be identified. I think Jennifer's right, we'd probably want to check that, but I think it's less likely to happen these days. You can just go across the border and get a different registration.
Yeah, but Glasgow and Edinburgh isn't going across the border.
No, but I think the Police Scotland checks on fit and proper using their database. I think it's probably easier because it's one database rather than different constabularies than it used to be.
And with the national data set that we all like and would like to see, would that help to capture this?
That would be very helpful.
Right. Thank you. Thanks okay. for that.
Thanks. Ali, I don't want to put you on the spot, but you mentioned working through fit and proper earlier with Police Scotland. So maybe you want to just add to that.
Yeah, our experience is that there is a good information protocols in place across authorities. So but I would like to just confirm that, like Derek suggested.
Okay, great. Thanks very much. So that brings us to the end of our questions. Thank you so much for coming in and joining us online today. I think that's been very helpful to hear the perspective of the councils. So thanks. Thank you. Just before we go to the next item, I need to ask a question if members are agreed that we will take item 4 in private. Are we all agreed? We're agreed. Thank you. And as that was the final public item on our agenda today, I now close the public part of our meeting.